We now take you live to the Central Texas Command Center in the heart of the resistance. It's Alex Jones.
Where to begin? We have that amazing Navy SEAL on, who's such a respected writer out there by a lot of the people that are inside the government and also in a lot of important positions. He comes highly recommended. We had him on last week. I was really impressed. So I've got Matt Bracken coming on for 2 hours, but we'll have open phones in the second hour with him. And I'm also going to play a lot of clips, cover a lot of news with him. But, I mean, the guy just absolutely knows what he's talking about and then makes all these very important connections that are just spot on. And, again, it's not that he agrees with me. I know what he's saying is accurate. And he brings even more depth to it. So he's going to be joining us coming up today from enemiesforeignanddomestic.com. David Knight will be doing a fabulous job, of course, honchoing the fourth hour. Did a fabulous job yesterday with Rob Dew, Josh Owens, and the rest of the amazing crew. Where to begin? Well, first off, the battle is joined. InfoWars itself is just piercing through, not just here in the United States or North America, but all over the world, and people across the planet of every race, color, and creed understand that globalism is the enemy and that divide and conquer is being used as a distraction. Here's the problem. There is a larger minority of people waking up and accelerating their education and their transformation. But there is a large minority of people of every race, color, and creed who cannot talk hardly. They don't. I mean, I've been watching social justice warrior videos all weekend. Quite frankly, they're so depressing to me a lot of the time, I can't watch them. But I went ahead and watched, let's not exaggerate, 5 hours of them this weekend. And this is zombiosis. I don't care if they're black, if they're white, if they're Hispanic. They all can hardly talk and just go, do you be racist? And there'll be a reporter getting beat up because they're white by white and black people. And they'll go, I'm not even a Trump supporter. Shut up. They just want to feel good and empowered and be dominant. It's a bunch of dumbed down betas running around just flipping out on everyone and totally driven by mainstream media. That is the unifying factor. No matter what color these people are, they all act exactly the same. Incredible video up on Infowars.com. We found it at DrudgeReport.com of a bunch of little kids waving Mexican flags and wearing sombreros saying the most vile things that we can't even repeat here. I don't mean just F you or this or that, but just absolutely nasty, nasty stuff with their parents there, very, very proud of this activity. Because these people have all been told, you're poor and don't have much of a future because of the gringos or because of America or because of John Wayne. When this country sure isn't perfect, but it was one of the best places for anybody to have opportunity. But these artificial chips are put on everybody's shoulders, where you see Trigglypuff throwing a fit like a giant baby. All she needs is rattles in her hands and just screaming, everyone's racist, because they let a couple, a gay guy and some other people that are like liberal conservatives just get up there and talk about free speech. And they're just frothing and flipping out. It gets weirder and weirder and weirder. It's just scary. So I don't know what we do about this mass of people that have been brought up in front of the television set that have no idea what planet they're on and that just get directed to go out and attack dog whenever the media says. Rob Dew and crew got back Saturday, and they shot hours and hours and hours of live footage and uploaded as much as they could. But when you're in San Francisco and you're in other areas of California and there's thousands of people out on the street running around, you know, beating people up and attacking police cars and burning things, there's not a lot of internet bandwidth. So they had trouble uploading a lot of stuff. More is coming as we speak. There's just hours of it. But our videos have had like 10 million views in the last few days of this. One of them's got 3+ million on Facebook alone. Another has over 1 million. There's just dozens of them that have 300,000, 400,000 apiece. And that's just on our channels. And the point is, this is dominating mainstream media. They have taken our clips everywhere. but of course given no credit. But the issue is we're doing what the mainstream media won't do. They won't actually go out into the crowds and show the hideousness of it. I mean, let me tell you, we're talking about like 18-year-old women that look like they weigh 300 pounds with gang tattoos all over them, just absolutely screaming and running wild. And then there'll be people out there with InfoWars shirts saying mass murderers agree gun control works. And the folks run over and threaten to physically attack him, and the guy stands his ground. So they don't. But other people, some of which weren't even Trump supporters, get beaten up. And they're telling people, I'm not even here for Trump. I'm here to see this. Shut up, white bitch. Boom. All because the media said, go out and fight back against this phantom of all these racist white people. Let me explain something. This is social engineering 101. White people were first put in the position of being totally guilty and taking on all the crimes of humanity, like Jesus on the Christ or, you know, on the cross, and absolutely bought the whole leftist paradigm. Now, because this is getting so vicious on the other side, I'm watching real intellectual leftists now start to actually become racist and sink down to the level of all these brainwashed people. We do not need to go down this road, folks. This is total balkanization. We need a unified culture of private property, family, transparency in government, local control, free market, free association. But this is the globalist endgame to totally destroy not just our country, but the world by creating incompatible mixtures of groups of people. And the left telling the Muslims, you be radical, you mutilate your women, put bags over their heads, we'll all submit to you. But if anybody criticizes you in Germany or England, we will arrest you if you just barely even talk about a Muslim invasion. I see articles dozens of times a day where they're arresting people in Europe who just put out on Twitter, we're being invaded, we're in trouble. They arrest presidential candidates that are leading in the polls and call them racist. I mean, Marie Le Pen is more milquetoast than Ron Paul. Milquetoast candidates are called Nazis and all this garbage. And it's just ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. And what frustrates me is they'll have Obama and Hillary and people say, you know, it's UK needs to stay in the European Union because, you know, you're basically giving into Nazism if you don't. The euro was a Nazi project of how to take over and economically control Europe after they'd militarily done it. You don't want to keep troops occupied in the area. You want to pull out and have your puppet government. It was the Muslims that allied with Hitler in World War II, almost 100%. I'm not attacking Muslims. It's a fact. And it was the La Raza Mecha idea actually started with the Nazis in a big way during World War II, but it originally came from the plan of Aslan pushed in World War I by the Germans to break off the Southwest and make it a new Germanic kingdom because the Austrian and Hungarian Empire ran Mexico after the Spanish were thrown out and after Santa Anna was thrown out, the first dictator of Mexico. But see, no one even has the history. These people are running around calling for Aslan, a cooked-up fantasy Nazi idea to sell Mexico to try to take the Southwest back from the U.S. I mean, the richness of these people running around screaming Nazi, Nazi, Nazi when the German plan in World War I was the plan of Aslan and the plan of San Diego. I mean, these are facts, ladies and gentlemen. And you try to tell people this, they just don't understand it. So what this is the giant Latin American population that historically would fit right in with free market and success, which Latin America had in a few areas when they got colonialism out in Venezuela and Argentina and other places, removing the whole thing and just turning it into socialist, race-based, mind-control garbage. So the country's in a lot of trouble. And I just want to say that Rob Dew and Josh Owens did a really great job getting out there and dealing with all this. But this is what the public schools and taxpayer money pays for. Now, that said, humongous broadcast lined up today. I want to get into the economic news first. This is very, very dire. People need to be aware of this and know about this when we come back. I also want to get into the latest on the campaign. Some really good news is happening. Ted Cruz's support softens among the delegates he courted. Just because he's running a con game with the Bushes and others that, oh, votes never counted. It's backfiring. Even the CIA-run National Review is now backing off and saying Cruz delegates waver as Trump gains momentum. I told you years ago that Glenn Beck is going bankrupt, basically, without officially doing it. I mean, I've been approached by the networks that have his channel trying to sell it to me. I'm like, no way. Don't want that anchor around my neck. And I mean, I knew about this years ago. I didn't really talk about it. I just said, well, I hope he pulls up. Now he's come out in a video, basically said, I have to lay off 40 people and I'm in all this trouble because I did the right thing. No, you hitched your wagon to Ted Cruz, who was a sleeper agent, who I thought was pretty good until the last 6 months, who's now uncloaked himself as a globalist operative par excellence, Obama 2.0. So I ignored the pedigree of Ted Cruz, but now it's clear he's an operative. And anyone hooking their wagon to him is destroying themselves. So listen, the Republicans can shoot their mouth off about where they're ready to kill the party and give it to Hillary. You're actually going to do that. And hey, my ratings only go up, but I still think it's immoral. You know, I don't think we'll survive Hillary. I mean, Trump's a gamble, by the way. I don't completely trust him, but I'm just telling you right now, anybody who's against Trump is a crazy person. I have a stack of reports out of North Africa, out of the Middle East, out of Eastern Europe, out of Asia, and out of the Caribbean. All of those nations are and those regions are reporting record mass exodus out of the third world into the crumbling first world, the aging, doddering, decadent first world. And quite frankly, I don't blame the giant third world hordes, and that's what they are, of humanity. But they are hordes pouring in. And they're not being organized into some type of industry, ladies and gentlemen. They're being organized into political sycophants, time bombs, to be used by the technocrats in the final takedown of planetary liberty. It's amazing. In fact, let me right now just get into some of the economic news here. It's out of the Wall Street Journal. This tech bubble is bursting. Despite record amount of money flowing into venture capital, funding for startups is drying up, which means it's going into a 2000-2001 trigger, the article says. Puerto Rico will default on government development bank debt. Unprecedented. Bloomberg, that will cause a cascade. And guess what? Puerto Rico has record immigration to the United States. As deadline comes and goes, Puerto Rico's debt crisis grows. The canary in the San Juan coal mine is what it's called in the Christian Science Monitor. Bank of England busy preparing for BRICS exit vote. Bank draws up plans for run on sterling and interest rate dilemma ahead of vote. A run on sterling. A run on the British pound, a run on silver, a run on everything. My little gut tells me gold might be a good investment now. But personally, I wouldn't even tell you to get into it. It's all a gamble, but paper money is the sure loser down the road. I mean, it's bottom line. Inside the secret meeting where Wall Street tested digital cash, Bloomberg, that's a huge report. I remember Kaiser was on 6 months ago talking about, I can tell you now, in secret meetings, they're testing cash going on. We need to get him on. He has the inside sources. The latest Berkshire debacle. Investors reject climate change report. Associated Press. He's also out saying diet drinks don't make you fat because he's such a big investor in them. So he wants his liberal social justice warrior henpecking nanny state, but not when it actually affects him. And he also is trying to force his board and the investors to go along with this whole bent towards carbon taxes and the rest of it. They're not going along with it. I thought everybody agrees. I thought it's universal. I thought everybody knew. But in my whole immigration stack, I've got the reports we're going to breakdown of what's happening with just total exodus here to the U.S. And if the illegals are smart enough to not be illegals, but just to get a travel visa here, which most countries the U.S. has with them, unless you're Iran or North Korea, you got enough money to fly in, no coyote needed, no Chinese smuggler, 10 grand needed. You just get on the plane, you land in Los Angeles from China, tens of thousands a week, some weeks. It's 10,000 plus a month on average. There are more Chinese women now, according to the Associated Press and the Fed's numbers. You just type in Chinese, now the biggest immigrants. But you look at it, it's women are bigger than Mexicans, folks. Think about that. Coming here to have a baby for free. 2 weeks before their water breaks, they fly in, they go in, they have the baby, it's a citizen, boom. Now she can start moving to get daddy in. And you go, well, fine, let's just be loving and liberal. We don't have the money. We don't have the money. There it is, USA Today. We don't have the money, people. And here's the deal. Chinese immigrants built much of this country. That's why there's a lot of Chinese folks on the West Coast. That's where the railroad finally ended. Last stop. But those were Chinese people there working themselves to death, not showing up to be turned into social justice brainwashers. Asian anchor babies, wealthy Chinese come to Southern California to give birth. You're that wealthy Chinese. Why not? That's why they're wealthy. They're penny pinchers. I saw reports where there are Chinese families coming here that are worth tens of millions of dollars, but they want to have their kid be a U.S. citizen, not just the money they save, and it's all paid for. And you go to the richest areas of Austin, folks, there are just rich Chinese everywhere. Just their wives walking out with like $3,000 bags. I've been at the Domain, big fancy area before, shopping for my mom, Mother's Day, and it's just like Chinese everywhere with just huge containers of $3,000-$4,000 purses and jewels. You go into Tiffany's, you buy mom and, you know, $1,000 necklaces. They're like buying $50,000 necklaces. These are the Chinese Communist Party members that already looted their country. Now they come here to get another free ride. I mean, we are the chumps of the galaxy. I got big fan arena news.
We're on the march.
It's on Drudge. Empire. Look at drudgereport.com if you're a TV viewer. Radio listeners, I'll describe it for everybody and go over it here. We've got video. Dreamers flip off Trump supporters, shout expletives at passing cars. Because the culture is now how to be a gangster thug. That's what Hollywood and TV and culture has done. It's killed Mexico. It's killing the U.S. It's Hollywood and the drug dealer culture. From the government criminalizing drugs, it created the giant criminal underground. Let's continue. Poll. Trump pops the lead over Clinton. Now, let's get to this. Beck says everyone must fast and pray for 24 hours as he raises his new priesthood led by him. I mean, I've never seen such a insincere, fake, puffed up guy wearing frat sweaters around his neck talking about Ted Cruz being some type of Christ figure. I'm going to throw up. And then this little giblet right underneath it. Carly falls off the stage. That's that Infowars.com report. We're going to play that video here in just a few minutes. And it does look like one of Ted Cruz's kids pushes her off. I mean, I really like James Woods, but I got to ask myself, what is his problem supporting that bobblehead, man? I mean, just another freakazoid corporate hack job who went in with a failing Hewlett-Packard and sold off most of it, screwing the employees over. I mean, look. If you're going to be a CEO, at least have some type of success. I love how she falls off and Cruz just doesn't even know what's going on. I just can't handle it anymore. It really is sick. So we're going to be talking about that. Really important news on the campaign front. I want to also get into CIA director. We don't lie here at the Running Man. There they are, Whitman, Price, and Todd. Their debt to society paid in full. I thought Whitman, Price, and Haddad won the Running Man. Oh, they won all right. They're last season's losers. I'm harkening back to the Stephen King short story. They got turned into the Running Man. I'm sorry. If you haven't seen it, you don't get what I'm talking about. It's just having the CIA director up there lie. The known Wahhabist converted to radical Islam, lives in Saudi Arabia for over a decade. Let's put him back on screen for TV viewers. And this guy, this agent of Saudi Arabia that runs around kissing them on the cheek and holding their little hands. I mean, how creepy. All those old men walk around those nightgowns and just their beards and everything. It's just Creepville. CIA director, 28 pages contain inaccurate information. Oh, well, then release it then. Buddy, we know that over 100 FBI agents, defense intelligence officers, and a bunch of other federal agencies, more than a dozen federal agencies, spoke in classified briefings to Congress before the 9/11 Commission ever got created by George Bush, and then Zelikow wrote the report they certified, and 6 of the 10 said it was all a fraud. The congressional report is what went on. And I've interviewed some of the whistleblowers that were in Congress. She's coming on very soon, Sybil Edmonds and others, who was the FBI translator. She was there for years to the day of 9/11, listening to the whole plan be set up. And our own agencies didn't even care it was known. It was like they're running sex slaves, they're running guns, they're running drugs, they're working with ISIS. Al-Qaeda back then is the name. And there's army teams wanting to kill bin Laden and CIA teams wanting to kill him. And then the higher-ups are like, no, 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 over and over again protecting him. And she's listening to this. She's Turkish, Arabic speaker. But she's not the only one that went public. A lot of folks got killed that went and spoke to Congress. And then we've got the head of the CIA coming out and looking at us and saying, oh, it's inaccurate. Preparing in case it does come out to say it's not true. They fought tooth and nail to cover up that report. They did the whole 9/11 commission to abscond the truth and cover up what went on earlier. So we're going to get to that. ISSA says Clinton investigation likely to extend beyond election. She needs to be stopped now, ladies and gentlemen. We've got MIT reports on AI I want to get to. I want to get to a lot of it. Got a bunch of clips to play as well. Before I go any further, people are really smart. My listeners are incredibly smart, and that's not patronizing. It's true. We have never been selling more storable food as we are right now, ever. One reason is we're selling it for incredibly low prices, and it's super high quality. But that's not it. I personally have been trying to get storable food into the office, more generators, medical equipment at my house. I personally have been trying to get my getaway out in the country in case everything, you know, gets turned off. There's no point of being here. So I've got fallback positions, but I seriously think it is now a serious possibility, maybe even a probability, that we're going to have a giant world war, martial law, power turned off. I mean, the government is digging in. The elites are digging in. I would be insane if I wasn't. But I am trying to harden this facility. And the food's coming in, the medical supplies, all of it. We've got the generators. We've got the propane stored, the solar panel systems. I mean, I'm not playing games. Because they want to have 21st century warfare where they incrementally turn things off. Now, I'm in a somewhat protected globalist enclave. And I've seen the studies, I've seen the little admissions here and there. There's not really connecting dots. There's so many dots, it's a clear image. They have what they call regional capital cities. Denver's one, Austin's one. They've got areas outside Maryland where they've got alternate governments. But they have agreements where the state district, UT, and then Tarrytown does not have its power turned off even during blackouts. That's all controlled. And then where I'm at isn't in that agreement, but it's in a sub-agreement industrial that we're the next to be turned off. There's a reason I moved here 9 years ago. And I really know what I'm talking about. I study things. I'm not bragging. If anybody else wanted to know how the world worked and not how football, you know, every detail of what size jock strap someone wears or what color their helmet is or where they went to college or how much they bench press, that data isn't going to help me or my family. See, I don't dream about other men and watch other men pat each other on the butts and act like tough guys, all these swollen NFL guys you see just think they're God, like big dumb cows strutting around. I mean, give me a break. I'm gonna throw up. I don't live in fantasy land and comic books and in TV shows and movies. I can go watch a, you know, Superman or something. I think it's interesting, but I don't. That isn't my manhood, and I'm not bragging. I'm not putting people down either. It's just this is fantasy land. This is fantasy land. I mean, I don't care about Hollywood stars anymore. I never really did, but I mean now completely over it. Wow, is it liberating? Just none of this fake stuff matters to me. So much so that I get disconnected with it. And I need to focus on it more because that's where the real brainwashing is going on. But I admire cool people that are cool musicians that have and Hollywood folks that have the courage to speak out. But I admire their courage and their intellect, not that they're just in some movies. But it's really weird. Everybody I really like, it turns out, is a patriot because I already resonated with them and picked up something. But we've just got to break with the popular culture. It's artificial. It's a lie. It's garbage. It's culture, human killing trash. I don't know how I digressed off into that, but I was talking about listeners. People are buying storable food at InfoWarsStore.com because they've shopped. They've looked. It really is high quality, freshly packed in the amazing plastic containers that you pay $30-$40 for at Walmart. I mean, these are the snap-on tops, the really nice, you know, thick quality rubber, and then it's all sealed in packages inside. 5-star ratings. But what scares me more is the knowledge of the crowd. People are buying storable food hand over fist right now because they see what's happening. They see the elite buying food. They see what's going on. They see what's happening. And it's kind of bittersweet because I don't want to see what we've been warning about come true. For me, it's like I'm hoping we can fix things. I'm hoping sun comes through the clouds. I'm hoping things aren't as bad as we think. But I see the general population just as concerned as I am and resonating with my concern because they have their own experiences that tell them how serious things are. And you see the preparations going on. It's crazy. Now, my Patriot Supply, and I'm going to finish up here, powers InfoWarsStore.com and our storable food. It's the exact same food, drop shipped from them. We call it InfoWars Select. It's their full spectrum, highest quality, 30 to 40% off with our private label. Now, that's how I contractually got around the fact that they already have some of the lowest prices in the industry. I can get 10% off anytime I want with a regular deal, but I can't do it at 30 or 40%. And I did talk to them this morning, and they said, look, you're only allowed to do this like 2 days, you said. And you've been doing it a week now, and we got our factory on full blast, you know, in Utah. And we actually, it's taken over everything. And some of our other folks are getting mad. And I said, well, just give them the same deal then, okay? I mean, you're making your profit. I'm basically cutting out my profit. And I just want to have a smaller profit but totally dominate and get folks prepared. Win, win, win. That's how it works. See, we're making even more money now by discounting it way below anybody else. That's called capitalism. But I'm going to have to stop. Okay, I'm going to have to stop. It may just be a day or two. I don't know, but that's the way it is. And they just said, you got one more day, and I'm going to, on the phone later, just twist some arms. And I'll be honest, they're great patriots, high quality. That's why I went with them. They've got great water filtration systems, the Alexa Pure, all their other systems. Super high quality water filtration, InfoWarsStore.com. It's the place to get it all. They've got survival style systems that are excellent as well. We've got so much there. But we're offering something, not just 30 or 40% off, depending on which item it is, at InfoWarsSelect.com or InfoWarsStore.com with horrible food. We're offering always 10% off of water filtration with promo code WATER. But now all preparedness items, and I'm going to have this added to the water filter, so it'll be 20% total, 10% off, and then another 10% off with the promo code WATER at checkout. But the water filters, the shortwave radios, the high-quality non-GMO seeds, the G-Shock watches, the TheraSafe in case of nuclear leaks. In fact, I'm calling it a preparedness item because it is. Survival Shield is a preparedness item. That's it. I'm expanding. I just decided to do this. All the nutraceuticals are 10% off on top of whatever discounts there are. X2, DNA Force, everything. And I'm doing that until Friday, and that's it. And I'm going to have to stop the food probably in the next 24 hours. I'll see how many arms I can twist. Believe me, I twist arms. The vicious, thumb-at-the-mouth capitalists running around dominating. Excuse me. InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals, InfoWarsStore.com. Take advantage. You can get 10% off additional when you sign up for auto ship. Free shipping on orders of $50 or more. Anthroplex is back in stock. But everybody needs Survival Shield, Nation Iodine. Secret 12, vitamin B12, super high quality. It's all available. By the way, they miscalculated in the computer. We have a little bit more Super Male Vitality, but it will sell out today. Anthroplex was sold out for 2 months. It just came back in. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. You can also call toll-free, 888-253-3139. And that's what funds this operation, so it's a win-win. Thank you for your support. All right, let me now just get into the situation with the Trump campaign. A lot of really good things are happening. The reason I like Roger Stone is that he doesn't come on here as a political analyst and tell people what he wants to happen or what he thinks is happening. He tells me privately, you name it, but also on air what he really thinks is going to go on. And then it ends up happening. Whereas I see the other people like Hillary and Ted Cruz, they'll just say whatever they want to try to create perception. But Stone has said over and over again that he thinks it's going to backfire them trying to steal the election. He predicted on the show 9-10 months ago they'd do it. It's now happening. They don't want Trump to complain like he's a sore loser. He ignores them and says, you're being robbed. They've never stolen delegates like this. It's contested if it's close. And it's blowing up in their face. So this is really good news. And you can have Ted Cruz running around with his con game. And look, I don't like attacking Ted Cruz. I don't like that he betrayed people. I don't like his wife's Goldman Sachs and he's a Bush baby and that he's a globalist and she helped write the TPP. And then, I mean, I wanted to believe as a Texas senator, he did a lot of great things in his, you know, cover story for 4 years in the Senate. I wanted to believe that Ted Cruz was for real. But the guy is a complete fake. And the biggest tell, we've got these clips when we come back, is he's out there saying Donald Trump is racist and creating division and that he's still causing the riots when Donald Trump hasn't done anything. I mean, maybe 6 months ago, if somebody was punching somebody, he'd say, yeah, kick that guy's ass. Or, yeah, great job, take that guy out. That's normal. That's just being real. But he hadn't even done that. He's been very wimpy about it for like 6 months. And in Chicago and everywhere else, the mainstream media won't show you what's happening. That's why I've had to have my reporters at great expense. Thank you for your support. You're financing all this, folks. It's where your money goes, to the tip of the spear in the fight. When you support us and pray for us. And we're just there everywhere now. We're there and we show what really happened. And because it's there, the media can't ignore it now because we're there getting it out. That's why you need to be at all these Trump rallies and other events as a citizen journalist. If you got to go undercover with a Bernie shirt, buy one now. Go undercover. Really get these folks behind the scenes. Go back to the Ford Foundation meetings with them. Infiltrate these groups. You'll win the Pulitzer Prize of real media. They ought to start having a real award every year for like $200,000 or something. I mean, I want to praise real journalists more, like a $1 million award. I just don't have that money. You know what? I'm announcing every year that I can do it. Because quite frankly, I haven't paid myself and we're 5 months into this year. I've not been paid. I'm not complaining. I'm just like, throw all the money in, attack. I love it. I'm getting paid by defeating the enemy. I'm absolutely high as a kite off of it. But the crew's doing great. And we're moving forward. We're getting more equipment, more studios, more reporters. We're taking action. But you need to get out there, folks. We can't cover everything. You need to infiltrate. This is a war. You are soldiers in a fight for humanity. You are the humet. You are the operatives of liberty. You're unstoppable. You've got the light of liberty in your eyes and your gut and your heart and your mind. And so when we come back, I'm going to get into all this because it's big. The whole lie's imploding, folks. This is epic what's happening right now. I think they're really thinking about killing Trump. My gut tells me they're going to make a move. So just know that that guy's on a suicide mission. You can't help but admire it. We're going to come back, though. Ted Cruz's support softens among delegates he courted. A lot of them are starting to ask questions. See, that's the key. That's the key. So, Trump did the right thing coming out. And you notice we started talking about it here 9-10 months ago with Richard Reeves and Roger Stone. They're going to steal it. They're going to steal it. They're going to steal it. Sure enough, they tried to steal it just like they tried to do with Reagan, but even more bold. They tried to sell the con game going, I'm winning the popular vote. The people spoken. My name's Wooden Indian Ted Cruz. Count Dracula. Pinocchio squared. It didn't work. And now the delegates themselves are going, well, wait a minute. Why do I belong to Ted Cruz? And why am I supposed to go for him? That's not really true. I mean, delegates represent the votes and pledge to that. And if you think that hasn't collapsed by now, wait until Cleveland. They're going to try to steal it in Cleveland. This is the arrogance of these psychopaths. But it's not going to work. This is history happening right now. But even if they do steal it, devastating to the globalists. We cannot lose by fighting. We lose by laying down and buying their bull. Ted Cruz's support softens among the delegates he courted, New York Times, and even the National Review, the little sweetie pies, run by the CIA, just like Miss Magazine, got to control the major movements. Well, guess what? You don't control this one, boys. Cruz delegates waver as Trump gains momentum. That's right. Down in the polls with zero margin for error heading into Tuesday's critical Indiana primary, Ted Cruz could be forgiven for seeing a silver lining in his apparent strength with unbound Republican delegates until Donald Trump's romp through the Northeast last Tuesday abruptly changed the subject. The political world was captivated as Trump supporters were infuriated by the Cruz campaign's successful effort to elect large blocks of friendly delegates at a series of state primary conventions. Yeah, Trump wins five states, but it doesn't matter. They're all starting to go for Cruz. I'm sorry you want a landslide. That's not how it works. I win now. People go, no, you don't. And like arrogant delegates would go on TV and go, super delegates, oh, I'm the governor. I'm going to vote for Cruz. I represent a third of the delegates. You're like, what? We decide. And George Will writes op-eds where he comes up with all these complex excuses and we just can't have the will and we've got to have the... In fact, David Knight was reading on air yesterday. If David's back there, can somebody get that article from him where he was reading the George Will column using all these fancy words and stuff to confuse what it is. Hey, we're ignoring the election. We just act like you have a popular vote because we don't like who you're selecting. We're going to just ignore it. And they've had almost every talk show host on radio nationwide, the ones they can bully. Some of the big ones that are so big they're independent to a certain extent, like Hannity and Limbaugh, haven't gone there. They've still been supporting Trump because they know where their audience is, or at least tacitly, halfway. But George Will. Yeah, there's the article in the Washington Post. What was the headline on that one? Just print it for me. There it is. If Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. So then he's just saying sabotage it and give it to Hillary. And then he's got all these weird excuses. And just George Will, a pseudo-intellectual with that stupid Bob big boy hair. I'm so sick of these little cutesy goody boys. That just is so goody and they're so nice. And they sit there and slime bag around. George Will needs to be slapped upside his head metaphysically. I mean, just another sniveling white shoe boy. He knows it all. He knows best for you. He's got all the answers. You know how to run this country in the ground, you sicko. So sick of establishment Republicans. They're the worst filth on the earth. At least the Democrats are honest about their will to destroy everything and turn everybody into idiots and big maggot-infested, crumbling government housing complexes. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen. Stay with us, InfoWars.com. Coming to you from the United States of America, founded to be the new Atlantis by the founders, now occupied by globalist forces of Satanism, broadcasting worldwide from the former great state of Texas, now deep in occupied FEMA Region 6. We've got an amazing guest coming up. We'll introduce him in the next segment. Just leave it at that. But here is the article. How good is my team? Nico Acosta had this in here printed within 60 seconds of me asking for it. They're like fast gun drawing in there with whatever I talk about. They're just Googling it and putting it on screen. I love doing that because that really freaks the globalist out when you just constantly pull up whatever we're talking about instantly. I'll have like, you know, ABC News here or whatever over the years, and I'll say, and this person called for world government. That person, I'm like, no, you didn't. In seconds, we have it up. Oh, here it is. That's another world government than the one you're talking about. And then at dinner, the ABC News anchor goes, yeah, I know it's all bull. We're just mercenaries. Why are you a mercenary? Why don't you go build your own thing and have your integrity? Don't trade your passion for glory. And then you'll rise to the top. And you won't even want the glory once you get it. Because you already had the honor, which is beyond glory. Glory will fade and pass away. Being honorable and the decisions you make lives on forever through other people. So that's why I'm not scared to die. Because my actions, my art, my ideas transcend, just like yours do. That's why the elite are scared of the free human spirit, the dynamic human spirit that refuses to submit. Empowered individuals is what the Pentagon says they're most worried about. Not violent people, but disruptors. With disruptive technology, disruptive music, disruptive poetry, disruptive art, disruptive ideas. These are not an elite. A real elite wants to see humanity's wings spread. No, they want us down in the cave while they soar in the sky. They're not even soaring in the sky. They instead perch, only flying a few dozen feet into the air, on the dead trees, looking at us down in the pit. And they go and toy with the humans who they've gouged their souls out, their eyes out. And they're just like Helen Keller stumbling around, and the buzzards hop around in victory like a cat playing with a half-dead mouse. Oh, aren't we great? Oh, aren't we powerful? Ugh. You know, just, you're pathetic is what you are. You're pit demons. Wanted to add a GD to the front of that, but I didn't do it. But you are damned to hell. And that's not a curse. That's what you are. I'm not even judging you. I can just see you spiritually. You're already in hell. You hadn't figured it out yet. You already crawled in there. Your soul already dropped to the center of it. You're now just a reflection, a tunnel, a vortex, a smelly, giant, blubbering tick just begging to be kicked off a cliff forever and out of our universe. You'll be with yourselves down there. Now, let's continue. This is George Will, the arrogance, the hatred of the American people, the false bravado, the hubris, the aplomb. If Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. And then he has three paragraphs before he drops the bomb. A convention's sovereign duty is to choose a plausible nominee who has a reasonable chance to win, not to passively affirm the will of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protracted process. He says there, we decide who can win. We decide, as the party chiefs, as the oligarchy. Oh, but there's an episode of people thinking they're voting, and it's protracted and easy. Protracted, episodic. I use big words. I'm George Will, and I talk with a real straight monotone as if I'm an intellectual when I'm a fop, a fake, and I bet money on intelligence agency asset. Oh, you have your little badge, don't you, George Will? You're so important. You are a disease on this country and humanity, filth. We're going to have a very special guest joining us in about 5-10 minutes, Matt Bracken. He'll be here until the end of the third hour, so almost 2 hours. We're going to have open phones so you can ask this experienced Navy SEAL who works around the world what his view is on what's happening in the planet today. Very interesting perspective. Great writer, great researcher, a lot of smart folks respect him. Matt Bracken was on with us for an hour last week. I want to get him on for almost 2 hours today. EnemiesForeignAndDomestic.com, that's coming up. I'm Alex Jones with InfoWars.com. There are videos up on InfoWars.com and DrudgeReport.com that are so over the top. I can't even believe them, quite frankly. And what's even more surreal is most of them we shot. I mean, it is young children with their parents screaming the most horrible, nasty stuff you can imagine. It is people saying we're not criminals and then attacking people and attacking cars and trying to run crowds over and knocking people over. Just frothing idiocy. And then members of the citizen press, they're just trying to document it, who weren't even Trump supporters, but just trying to see what's happening. They're attacked. And we've got the interviews with the folks after they were attacked. So this is the bedlam that's going on, and it's all just mindless tribal idiocy because the mainstream media told them that Donald Trump, quote, hates all Mexicans or hates all blacks. No, Donald Trump said Mexico is collapsing into a narco-terrorist state with 100,000 dead, and that many of their criminals are coming up here, and that a culture of crime is forming all over the nation. But if you look at rap music and you look at the whole Tejano thing, it's morphed into like rap, and it's all glorifying the drug dealers and El Chapo. And let's be clear, El Chapo has been caught working for the CIA and is not a hero at all. I'm not for the drug culture. I'm for decriminalization because having it illegal is what gives the banks $500 billion a year here in North America alone. $500 billion. And big banks get caught with hundreds of billions in them. Everything from Wachovia to Wells Fargo, oh, little Berkshire Hathaway over there, and nothing gets done. Or in the case of Berkshire Hathaway's banking division, Wells Fargo, and with Wachovia, it was $378 billion laundered over 2 years, and they paid, what was it, $111 million fine. That's like you get caught robbing a bank for $3 million, you pay a $4,000 fine or something. This is the craziness that the system has set up and how dumb they think we are. And if you just joined us, I was reading an opinion piece in the Washington Post by George Will. If Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. And they say, just go ahead and just give it to Hillary. Then he goes on, quote, a convention's sovereign duty is to choose a plausible nominee. I thought the people voted for that. Who has a reasonable chance to win. Oh, you decide. Not to passively affirm the will of a mere plurality. Oh, the will of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protected process. You could teach an entire college course on that arrogant statement. One other you could teach it on is Karl Rove to the New York Times, the Washington Post, at a cocktail party in 2005. And they've been 2 years into Iraq, lied about the WMDs, you know, all of it. And they said, but sir, it was lies. It's been. He said, listen, we control reality. We're history's actors now. All you do is repeat what we say the new reality is. We may say the moon's made of cheese tomorrow. And you're going to report that. I control reality. You are a minion. And they were so scared of him, they wouldn't even say his name for 3 or 4 years in the press that he was the one that told him that. He didn't even say it off record. He's just walking around with a martini, you know, walking around to the women and going, it's like Richard Pearl was at some of those same cocktail parties, and I've seen it talked about in the press. He'd walk up to the best-looking female reporters. We're talking a 400-pound guy, huge black circles around his eyes, looks like the Penguin. He'd walk over to women and go, I kill a lot of people. They call me the Prince of Darkness. I'm really powerful. And the women just go, ugh. Hey, buddy, if you're actually killing people, women don't want to hear about it, okay? Do the killing over here and pet their puppies. That's what they like. But it just shows they're little boys, folks, that thinks he's going to go over and pick women up by bragging that he's a killer and loves to kill people, but couldn't fight his way out of a wet paper bag. But don't worry. He's really good at killing people. You know, my nickname's the Prince of Darkness. Can we put a picture of Richard Pearl up on the screen, please, for TV viewers? This is who infest D.C. This is who has taken this country over. This is who thinks we're a joke. So they now go on TV, Priebus and Curly Hughlin and George Will in their con games, and say, we don't go with the will of the people. Silly rabbit, voting's for kids. We don't need no badges. You don't need no stinking badges. And they've weaponized the culture. In fourth, fifth generation warfare, where they've so dumbed down the public across the board that large swaths of humanity, if you watch the social justice warrior videos, it's all of them. They just go, shut up, I'm intellectual, you're racist. They just virtue signal and people actually lovingly talk to them. Like there was a video we've got, we ought to cue that up and play that about in California and San Francisco, where this really smart guy, happens to be, you know, black and white, just a human, had to come out because he saw the previous videos of folks beating people up, and they just keep calling him racist, just because he's there to cover what's happening, and he's not even really a Trump supporter. But he has to support the free speech. This video's up on Infowars.com. It's very, very important because he just so eloquently crystallizes it even better than I could do. Here it is.
So why are you out here today? You know, I am a Trump supporter. I don't know if I would vote for him, but I have to support what he's standing for.
Yeah.
Because I've been seeing all this opposition coming from Bernie and Hillary supporters and sitting there talking about we're liberal, we're loving, we just want peace, yet they throw eggs at you and punch you in the mouth because they're peaceful and loving. I saw what went down in Southern California.
Right.
It got to me, I had to come out here and actually talk about what's going on. These people don't want to talk to you. That's the problem. They sit there and say they don't have double standards,
yeah,
and that they're not hypocritical. They'll come up to you and just yell and scream like you're nobody. We hate you. You're racist, you're misogynist, homophobic. I have black friends, I have white friends, I have Mexican friends, and supposedly I'm a racist. Wow, that's crazy. My family is black. We're all mixed, okay? So it has nothing to do with race. I think Trump is really just trying to get the sovereignty back in America when he's talking about the borders. Like,
right,
he's not saying, let's import all Muslims, let's import all Mexicans. He's talking about the drug pushers He's talking about the criminals. He's talking about them. He's not talking about good people that are going to work every day and paying their bills. And there's just too many of these misconceptions generated by the hype of the mainstream media. And people just kind of buy into it because of the herd mentality. I really urge people to, you know, read Edward Bernays' book on propaganda. When I read that book, blew my mind. Blew my freaking mind, man. That is a Bernie supporter because they love you. That's love right there. You see that? Look,
I don't think he supports anyone.
I think he just supports hate, but apparently I support hate. But you read Edward Bernays' book on propaganda, it blows your mind. It's like almost everything that's going on right now, he talked about it 100 years prior. It's crazy, you know?
He nailed it.
Yeah.
Did they find that guy over there, or what's going on?
No, they managed to escape the mob. Okay.
All right. So what was going on? The guy was—he threw eggs at a guy who was burning a flag.
The kid that they stole this kid's American flag and then burned it, and then hit the kid that had the flag with an egg. And so they were chasing the guy that threw the egg and stole the flag. It was the same person, apparently.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Interesting. Yep. Interesting doings here at the Trump protest. I don't know if. I might go check into my hotel right now. Looks like things are...
I'm done.
I'm supposed to fly out at 5, so I don't even know if I'm going to check into the hotel.
And the name of the video is, there's more of it, that's just part of it, Black Trump supporter calls out racist provocateurs as propaganda victims. And that's a great headline, but really it's Black Trump supporter exposes the idiocy of racist anti-Trump people. I don't know what you call it. It's just ridiculous. And then we've got this footage that just blows my mind. You know, used to when we were kids, I didn't do a lot of juvenile delinquent stuff, but a few times I was like 13, I'd go to neighborhood kids and run around and smash pumpkins at midnight. And yes, we had a game, I only did it a few times, where we'd throw eggs at police cars on Halloween so the cops would chase us for fun. Well, then the cops caught us one time, it's like, you idiots, you know, go home. Anyways, the cops seemed like he actually thought it was kind of fun and it was a game. I'm looking at it and get shot, I guess. But, yes, I've done dumb stuff like that. That's about the worst I did. We'd go paper cheerleaders, you know, I was like 11 or 12, you know, walk a mile to the cheerleader's house and throw toilet paper in the trees. I've done that stuff. But that's kind of what this is, but it's 2.0, where just the media hypes it that a bunch of idiot teenagers and people just go out and act like total morons and then beat people up and attack police cars and burn things. And then it's mixed with a bunch of weaponized race stuff just to attack free speech. It's total garbage. And none of them have anything to say when you nicely ask them questions. It's very sad. All I know is this. The world economy is imploding. Engineered crisis is being put into high gear. We're going to be covering it in the next hour and 45 minutes with our guest. He would have been on already, but... his computer totally died. His Skype totally crashed. His computer doesn't even work now. So he's going to be on the phone with us, so that's fine. This keeps happening to almost every guest, but I'm sure it's a coincidence. So that is coming up with our guest, Matt Brackett, enemiesforeigndomestic.com. He'll be with us to the end of the next hour. Open phones in the third hour. You can talk to the Navy SEAL, talk to a really smart writer, and ask your questions or make your points. We're going to talk about all these defaults with these different countries and Puerto Rico and different cities and the pension funds getting raided and how this is all cascading and how the government knows this is coming and other governments too, but they're trying to keep it quiet while they dig in. So we're here raising the alarm. We hope for the best, prepare for the worst. As George Washington said, don't be involved in foreign entanglements. But at the same time, to secure peace, you must be prepared for war. We must be war ready. That deters an enemy like nothing else. We need to be ready, prepared, involved, and informing to affect the battle. Matt Bracken is our guest for the next hour and 40 minutes or so. We're going to be up with the phones up in the second hour with him. Enemiesforeigndomestic.com is his site. I'm not going to go over his whole bio, but he's a former Navy SEAL, worked around the world. He's an author, and of course, he also... writes a lot of current articles on what's happening in the world. We had him on last week about the radical jihadist element and why would Europe bring 5 million of them in the last 3 years, hundreds of thousands here. The numbers are much bigger than they're saying. They claim that 400 or so have been brought in the last year to Texas. It's thousands in the high schools alone. 232 in the last year to Anderson High, my alma mater. That's in the newspaper. They don't even hide this stuff. And so why would they be telling us it's 400 for the whole state or 500 now? And then I've called the high schools and it's 200 here, 300 there, 100 here. And that's not counting the elementary schools. And the schools are saying, we need interpreters. We're in a crisis. What's the real number? I don't know. There's articles in mainstream news that planes land at Air Force bases and they just give them IDs and they're just there. Again, how does this all feed into all these big protectorates like Puerto Rico going completely bankrupt and defaulting, and now major, from California to Michigan, major municipalities just looting the pension funds, and the dot-com bubble part two about to bust, according to the Wall Street Journal, and the Royal Bank of Scotland saying, sell everything. That was the headline a month ago, 2 months ago. Something big is going on. I hope it can be averted or we can have a soft landing. But it's gone from possibility, in my view, to probability that all hell is breaking loose in the next 6 months to a year. And you see politically the crisis that's going on. There are a lot of forces behind the scenes that I know encouraged Donald Trump to run and, quote, save America. He knows about the globalists. He knows about all the stuff that's happening. Now, is this a double cross by some other crime group? I don't know. I'm just telling you the system is freaking out about Donald Trump. So I want to cover the waterfront and what we have left in this hour. This is a short segment, so you can just intro what he wants to cover with Matt Bracken and how all this ties together and how he sees different scenarios unfolding as they militarize and activate the social justice warrior zombies and as they roll out the economic warfare. So, Matt Bracken, glad we got your Skype back up, my friend. Great having you on last week. We got 4 minutes to break. What's your summation of what you're going to be breaking down today?
Yeah, that's a great way to come onto the show is seeing the blue screen of death.
Absolutely.
All the Mac people are saying, what's taking you so long? Okay. right as I booting up Skype, get the blue screen. Anyway, yeah, at the end of last hour, which is kind of funny because I just lost track of time. It was at my end, the cutoff. No conspiracy that I know of, but I wouldn't be surprised on the other hand. I was talking about tsunamis and the waves are coming. The earthquake has already happened way out at sea. And I went back and I looked up this story from 2004. There was a 10-year-old English girl named Tilly Smith. If you Google it or YouTube it, you'll find the whole thing. And she had just taken a class a month before, and it explained about earthquakes and tsunamis. And she was watching the tide rolling out at a beach in Thailand with her parents. They're intelligent people. They're grown-ups. They flew her there. And she's telling them, Mom, Dad, this means a tsunami is coming. We have got to go. It took this girl 10 minutes to convince her intelligent parents to go back to the hotel. They told staff, a Japanese tourist overheard the word tsunami and said, yes, I think it's tsunami. And that's when the staff finally at that one place started warning everybody. But we know that hundreds of thousands died because nobody knew. Well, a tsunami, an economic tsunami, hasn't hit us in several generations. Going back to, say, to the 1930s Great Depression. Well, we're watching the water going out. We're seeing these precursors, and we have to be the intelligent English girl and not the dumb parents that are going, what's that mean? The water's going out. Let's go down and take a look at the beached boats. I mean, you would think that intelligent people would understand something so simple. So it's not a surprise completely that the intelligent adults in the room are all saying things are fine. There can't be an economic crash. There are great minds in charge of all of this, and we'll just muddle through. This time, we're not muddling through. The tsunami waves are already on the way, and it's time to head for the high ground.
We're going to break down why you see these different factors coming together, I guess, in a perfect storm. The establishment admits now they're digging in. While weaponizing culture even more, like having us fight with each other, is going to help during a crisis. I really think this elite is pretty insane overall. Matt Bracken is our guest. We're going to come right back and kind of give him the floor to break all this down. And then get your questions and comments ready for the third hour coming up. We'll also intersperse a lot of the breaking news with him and get his take on what he thinks the different factions are inside this new world order. I'm Alex Jones. Infowars.com is the news site. Stay with us. We are here trying to scare you. I try to get myself concerned because I just get so comfortable living with this tyranny and watching all the signs and Europe arresting people that criticize open borders and all the tyranny going on, all the surveillance and the government opening the borders but tracking citizens and the TSA and just all the countless things that are going on and derivatives bigger than they were in 2008 and big mega banks saying get ready for more bailouts and NATO moving troops in on the Russian border. I mean, I'm going to go over all this with our guest today. It is just over the top what's happened. The defaults, the economic bubble we're sitting on, the biggest the world's ever seen. So I'm trying to get myself concerned. I'm trying to get myself ready. And again, I hope we're wrong. I hope things just magically turn out better. But I think things run from bad to worse. And we'll talk about the bad to the worse with our guest. We're going to him in one moment. Speaking of this, I personally have been getting prepared. So I said, I want to really push preparedness, which I've always been doing. It's just going to be prepared for earthquakes, whatever happens, you know, economic problems or you lose your job or whatever. Storable food is one of the most important things. The last 25 years, the folks at My Patriot Supply, Power, InfoWars Select, we're running a special that's got to end very, very soon. I've extended it 30 to 40% off, already the lowest prices at InfoWarsStore.com. We've also got 10% off all other preparedness items, the little car charger batteries we've got, the most high-tech, most affordable out there, the G-Shock watches, the water filtration, the non-GMO heirloom seeds, strategic relocation, the book and the film, solar-powered and crank shortwave radios, very inexpensive already. 10% off all preparedness items, including all the nutraceuticals at InfoWarsLife.com. I just decided to do that last hour. We're going to run this for a week, because I'm going to have to end the food very, very soon, but 10% off everything else. Sign up for auto ship, get 10% off additionally. Orders of $50 or more, free shipping, InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or simply call toll-free 888-253-3139. And the biggest thing is firearms, knowing how to use them, having a safety plan, having friends and family you can count on, water filtration, food, things like that. And quite frankly, not living in a mega city. Like a New Yorker in L.A. I mean, that is so freaking dangerous, folks. And I'm telling you, I live in a big city, too. But I live in a globalist protected city that they've got admitted management plans during all sorts of collapse to leave the power on here. But I don't even trust that. And look, I hope that isn't the case. I want to be clear. InfoWarsStore.com. By the way, I want to get our guest on sometime. I want to carry his books. I've told the crew, I think we're setting that up. He's written a bunch of books. You know, breaking down different globalist scenarios that really get you inside the mind of how they would carry something like that out. Again, our guest is former Navy SEAL, author, researcher, highly respected by a lot of great people who recommended him on the show. We really clicked when he was on enemiesforeignanddomestic.com. Okay, Matt, I'm going to try to shut up for the next 14 minutes or so before break. Give you the floor. You were saying that, I mean, the great story that's on record where the little girl says, hey, when the water goes way out, then we know that a tsunami's going to happen. And they listened finally, but took them 10 minutes. They almost didn't make it. I remember whatever year it was, Galveston got hit by, you know, 20-foot wall of water. And they always thought it was a hurricane or something, but some scientists today think maybe there was an earthquake out in the Gulf and that's what actually killed those tens of thousands of people, one of the worst disasters in U.S. history. But it's a great allegory, a great parable. Matt Bracken, please continue.
I think that right now the waves are already coming. And if you can picture a big dike system like New Orleans or London, they have a big system of dikes and berms going around that, you know, risky part of English territory. If they're made to have the capability, for example, of stopping, say, a 200-year North Sea storm, you know, like a perfect storm bringing giant waves down from the North Sea and high tides. But what happens if there's another earthquake on the, you know, coming from another direction and you're getting two waves? I think that's what's going to happen this fall, winter, definitely 2017. We're going to see a convergence of these waves that's going to overtop all of our defenses at the end of all of these scenarios. As one byproduct is a grid down situation. Once our cities don't have their electronic oxygen, their electrical oxygen, there will be a big bottleneck event, population correction. Cities just can't survive that way. They can't survive without power. They can't. We didn't consider this a century ago power was meaningless. People had ice boxes. An ice man brought a block of ice. And if you didn't have it, you ate more canned food. Today, that can't. Our economy can't work. Hospitals will become death traps. And the goblins that are already out in the street, you know, ready to throw punches, you know, racist mobster hordes are already out in the street. And this is when they're fat, they've got full bellies, their EBT card is working. How are they going to act when the EBT cards are not working? I think we don't need to be geniuses to see that this is similar to watching the tide going out and knowing the tsunami's coming on the rebound. You know, I before I go on, each time I'm introduced, it's always sounds like, you know, Navy SEAL is what Matt Bracken is. And it's almost to me, it makes kind of causes me a little bit of pain and a kind of like a, I'm not a combat veteran. I was in Lebanon. You know, we were ready to go and do anything anywhere. And it was a dangerous job, even in training. Helicopters crash, people get shot, even in peacetime or in training. But the guys that have been in the teams since 9/11, people need to understand something. Very few Americans are in the military anymore, but in the special ops community, it's been like World War III followed by World War IV followed by World War V. There are guys that have spent years and years of their lives in horrible places fighting for this country.
And so let's be clear.
I don't like being introduced as Navy SEAL Matt Bracken.
Sure, and that is on record that they engage in more combat. I mean, sometimes dozens of raids a day than anyone ever even thought about. The level of stress is just over the top.
And it's the same guys, and it really it tears up the families. People would like to go for 20 years. I did not. I was just paying for my Naval ROTC scholarship and having fun in the teams. I never planned to be I just wanted to be a shooter and an operator. I didn't want to become a staff officer. So, you know, and after Beirut, that was going to be my future. So I got out and did the boats and other things. But I want to really, at all times, anytime I'm introduced as a Navy SEAL, I want to say, look, I was a glorified.
Sure, the point is you're a smart writer and you've got a really clear perspective and a lot of smart people respect what you're saying. Right. So let's get into the facts. Let's get into the facts.
Right. Anyway, yeah, there's no avoiding what's happening now. And some of the clues that this is going to be a big, huge year are that they're not even hiding the conspiracy anymore. If you went back 10 years or 20 years, as soon as anybody on any, say, talk radio show or much less network television, God forbid it would never happen, anybody ever mentions things like, you know, Bilderberg, they immediately go into, black helicopter, conspiracy. That's a way of just disregarding it. Now they're not hiding it. Now Davos and Bilderberg are just part of the news. Like, of course, CNN is at Davos. Why wouldn't they be? We are always at Davos. Now they're giving it credibility. Well, who are these guys? I'm not saying it's like the same secret society with the same secret society handshake. It morphs, it changes. There's a lot of overlap. You know, there's Bilderberg, there's CFR, Trilateral Commission. I always get a good chuckle in the morning. I like to watch Morning Joe on MSNBC. And there's Mika Brzezinski. Look up Zbigniew Brzezinski in the Trilateral Commission. I mean, folks, it's just staring us in the face. And in July, they're going to meet in Dresden, the Bilderberg group. And I have to think this is going to be like an emergency meeting. And I wonder if it'll have to be relocated somewhere else, because by July, Dresden might not be a safe place for, you know, the Gulf Streams and the Falkwolfs or the Falkers to fly in. You know, these guys are trackable. Now they're coming out of the closet a little bit. They're showing their hand. Look at all the presidents that visit Bilderberg. That's sort of where you'd get the secret handshake. You know, that's where they see if you're going to be a team player, you know, a willing stooge, a patsy. You know, Bill Clinton comes to mind, along with many others. That's where the elite of the elite, the super elite, that's where the super elite meet to see who they can trust to be their political front men and stooges. You know, whether it's the European Union, national governments, America, but most of the people that are even in the pool of electability are already approved by the super elites. This, what you were saying about George Will, I mean, obviously he's part of the club. He's part of that DC super establishment. He's a trusted, proven, reliable journalist in the Soviet meaning of the word. You know, he's a team player. He won't rock the boat. What the super elites hate more than anything is a loose cannon, somebody who goes off script, somebody who can get a mass audience, blow InfoWars. You know, this is something wonderful you've been doing for years and years. You can be belittled, you know, you can be called whatever, a conspiracy theorist, but it's pretty funny now. They go and cover Davos and Bilderberg, and, you know, there's an InfoWars reporter. Now it's suddenly not quite as conspiracy. Now it's just reality. And I think that this summer, if Europe is not in full all-out, you know, Islamic versus European civil war, I'll be happy. I mean, I don't want to be right about these things. I'd love to be wrong about these things. But I wonder if Bilderberg is going to be able to even take place. Similar to Cleveland, this, if you look at this in California, what they're doing just at Trump rallies, imagine what a big purple bug light Cleveland is going to be. It's going to bring the black bloc, you know, out of the woodwork. And these guys don't live under bridges. They're paid. They all belong to committees of, you know, political action, non-governmental.
Yeah, you're talking about the so-called anarchists that are actually Maoist youth brigades funded by the major foundations.
Totally funded. And the money is, you know, if there was honest journalism going on, they'd be very interested to see, you know, who's printing the signs and who's paying for the hotel rooms for these, you know, supposedly philanthropic, you know, protesters. And these are actually Black Bloc and Aztlan, the Mecha people. Those are the ones out in California. I don't know if people are familiar with Mecha. It stands for the Chicano student movement, basically, in the Spanish spelling of it. But it's the same phonetic or homonym for a mecha, which is a match or fuse in Spanish. The logo of Mecha is a warbird holding a lit dynamite fuse. That's Mecha's logo. Now, it's been around since the 70s, this Chicano radical group. Look up the Plan of Aztlan. We're in it now. This is a destabilization process that they're rolling out. This is the out-of-order chaos. Now they're creating the chaos.
Just
this
like they bring in radical Muslims in Europe, it's radical folks are brought in here, and then once they get to the universities, they're absolutely there with all their white professors who are the communist operatives, admittedly, with money and everything, saying, yes, yes, do this. It is such a sickening plan, but you mentioned last week this. It's in the news today. I'll dig the article out in mainstream news. Europe preparing for civil emergency. Experts call it martial law, and they're preparing to suppress political speech in the next 6 months. So Europe is going under official martial law, civil emergency already.
It doesn't matter. It can't. It's you know, their plan is when the tiger breaks out of the zoo, we're going to jump on the tiger's back, put a bridle in its mouth, and then ride it back into the zoo and lock it back in. You know, good luck with that. They don't have the bench. They don't have the troops. Belgium was completely overwhelmed by what happened on one day. They had no bench. They've got nothing. There's no reserves. If there's a Beslan, a Bataclan, and a Brussels happening every day or week somewhere in Europe, the economy freezes. You can't just stay in these European cities. You know, even if the water is still running at that time, and live everybody just in there.
Let me ask you this question:
tower blocks. That's what's going to happen because the economy is nobody will be able to take a train or a subway.
Sure,
and that's
Matt,
how they get to work.
Matt, let me throw this at you. The elites you mentioned are very OCD. They're control freaks. That's admitted. They have a large plan. They admit this is part of their destabilization plan. They think out of this chaos, they'll get a diversion from their looting and what they're doing and use the crisis for more control. Order out of chaos.
Well,
order out of chaos. But here's my question. Here's my question to you. Do you think they're then engineering this, or are they unconscious of it, or are they delusional? Because if they want order, why are they bringing in tsunami-level crises or opening the door for it that I don't think they're going to survive?
I think that the way that they look at it, imagine if at the point in The Wizard of Oz, when they see him behind the curtain and they go pull the curtain back, all right? That's the super elite. That's Oz, the great and powerful. Well, Oz has a contingency, the great and powerful Oz has a contingency plan for when Dorothy and the Tin Man and the Lion get there, which is they have, flashbangs go off, the whole theater burns down, and Oz gets away in a Porsche, you know, with his gold. They're similar, the way I think of it, if you're on an airplane and it has like an engine go out and an explosion in the wing and you're leaking fuel, the flight crew is on the phone or on the intercom telling the passengers, don't worry, folks, we're going to make it all the way to the Canary Islands. We're not going to run out of fuel. And they know damn well they are running out of fuel. So they shoo everybody out of first class. They're all putting on parachutes. But on the intercom, they're saying, don't worry, folks, remain calm. Remain in your seats because there's only about 10 parachutes.
Just like the Titanic.
The Titanic or the Korean ship full of student researchers, as it was capsizing, as the officers and the crew are getting in the lifeboats on the intercom, they're saying everything's fine.
The same thing happened with the big cruise ship. Remember the cruise ship in Greece?
Yeah, go back to your room. Everything's fine. They never say, buddy, you better be running for the top right now, because they don't want to be swarmed like a crush of people getting into the one lifeboat. But the plan, as far as that goes, I don't think that they meet and discuss it in these terms, but a lot of people have the feeling, a lot of these, you know, the Davos Bilderberg crowd, what they're planning for is to emerge on the other side of the big emergency.
And consolidate.
I wrote about this in my essay, Burning Down the House in 2016. If they are going to have a world war, which will wipe out all the bad debt, essentially what's happened is, you know, if you understand algorithms, it's gone vertical. There's no more level of debt. We're at the end of Keynesian economics, the end.
The holiday's over.
We've hit the vertical wall. We can't invent it. We've got zero interest, which means shoveling money to Wall Street, but this is like hitting Frankenstein with the paddles. Come on, Frankenstein, you know, he's not dead. Look, Frankenstein's not dead. But if anybody thinks that the actual economy is going to get up and start moving again, they're completely dreaming.
That's right. There's flies all over Frankenstein. He stinks. Arms are falling off. And they're just saying, right. Look, he's they're never looked better. Obama said the economy's never been better. And it's like Frankenstein's head falls off. We'll be back with our guest straight ahead to get more into this, because they admit, I have the stacks of articles here, mass immigrant waves are just intensifying everywhere as the third world sinks. So what's the chain trigger? Pat Bracken's our guest, writer, researcher. Everything he's saying while he's talking, I just have stacks of news basically saying the same thing, but telling us everything's okay. So while he's talking for TV viewers, I'm going to be going through articles just showing you where they admit big defaults, state level, pension level, Puerto Rico, record numbers of people exiting the third world, the government just letting them in. Illegals coming in get more than a Social Security recipient. That's mainstream news. I'm going to be going over all of that. I mean, this is an elite. They organize their main plan. They meet at different meetings to steer it. But because we've exposed it and others have exposed it, and you've exposed it, more and more, they are going to a policy of just going, okay, there's world government. Or George Will, in the article I mentioned earlier, says, quote, a convention's sovereign duty. Oh, they're sovereigns. That means royalty. The Republicans, the party. That's like the inner party in China. The Central Committee. The convention's sovereign duty is to choose a plausible nominee. They decide who has a reasonable chance to win. They decide who can win. Not to passively affirm the will of the people, of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protracted process. I mean, that is fascistic sophistry. I mean, it is total pseudo-intellectual tripe, a fancy way to say your vote doesn't count. Well, guess what, you little con artist, George Will? You guys have been acting like that vote counts, but because we're not selecting who you want, you say it doesn't. You say you passed a rule back in the 70s. We didn't try to use it till now. Last time you thought about it was with Reagan. Now I'm going to go back to our guest. We're about to start the next hour, but continue, Mr. Bracken, with where you say we're going and what the establishment's going to pull and these different waves, the debt bubble, the massive migrant invasions, the social justice warrior, Ford Foundation, radicalization program. I mean, what do you think the elite's thinking? I mean, I got your allegories that were excellent of the Wizard of Oz. Well, what he'd really do is if they caught him, he'd blow up the palace, have a pre-produced fake video of Dorothy being a suicide bomber, when really he blew it up and flew off in his jet copter to his next base. But, I mean, I don't think they're going to get away with it. Look at the arrogance of all these people thinking they could just steal an election. It's not flying. I mean, I really think in history it shows that megalomania becomes a delusion in and of itself, and the elite's biggest enemy is themselves.
Yeah, it's interesting. The jet copter, the super elites do have a few small Achilles that are exposed. Obviously, you know, if you're a Sun Tzu fan, you know you minimize and hide your own weaknesses. Well, one of their weaknesses is security. And their paranoia about security, which is really why it's so rich when people like Zuckerberg talk about the need for America to bring in way more refugees. While, you know, he has a 700-acre estate on Kauai on the North Shore, you know, with like Blackwater security keeping everybody out. You know, he's got his place to go, but he wants us to take more refugees.
Or the Vatican really with its 200-foot walls, or right. The big wall they're building around the White House.
But they fly in private jets. They do not go tourist class on American Airlines, believe me. And they do not go through TSA security either. Now, that none of these guys owns a jet with their, except for Trump. It's interesting. Trump actually does own a big jet that says Trump right on the side. But Zuckerberg and the rest of these folks, they will never. You won't find a jet that has his name on it. It's all holding companies and leases and sharing and so forth. But when they're flying to Bilderberg in July, it'll be very interesting to see, you know, the flight schedules, and then sort of untangle the tail numbers, because that's the big guys. That's the big guys. You can track them by their Gulf Streams for sure.
Absolutely. And they're building a world that will destroy them historically. It's like the Rothschilds at some level funded Hitler, and then Hitler did kill some of them in France. It's like, well, they think they can control everything.
They can't control everything, but I think that their plan is to emerge on the other side when the fire's down and the ashes are cooling. Then they can fly back from Patagonia or New Zealand.
Exactly. Stay there. They're all going to New Zealand. That's right. We'll talk more about your research, how we stop this, with Matt Bracken straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. Check out his site, Enemies Foreign and Domestic. I'm Alex Jones, your host, Matt Bracken. As you can see right there, let's punch up the side camera. I love it. I bet he thought that was like a 3-minute break, not a 1-minute break. But he's right over there when he comes back. We will talk more with him. Really smart guy. Really enjoy talking to him. Very humble guy, like so many of those great folks are. But in a moment, he'll be coming back. Here are some of those articles I was mentioning. As deadlines come and go, Puerto Rico's debt crisis grows. CS Monitor. A canary in the San Juan coal mine is what Bloomberg says. Here's another one. Puerto Rico will default on government development bank debt. Again, what does that signify? Again, what will that mean? And then as he's speaking here, this is a short segment, long segment coming up, I'm going to go over some of the other articles about illegals to get more money than Social Security recipients. That's official. All of this. But really, overall, there is a hatred of the West, of Americana, of free market by the elites. That's why they're desperately trying to consolidate power. Matt, I've been asking a lot of the questions. This is a short segment, but getting back to other points you want to impart to folks.
Yeah, you know, people should look at history in a lot of respects in terms of wave theory. Look up what a Kondratiev wave is, which is sort of a multi-generational economic cycle postulated by a Russian economist at the beginning of the 20th century.
You're talking about turnings.
Yeah, and When people forget, when you have 3 or 4 generations on Wall Street that never suffered a wipeout crash, like a 1929 type of crash, their normalcy bias says it can never happen.
They're like dodo birds. They're like dodo birds.
It's different this time. You know, that's a famous saying. It's different this time. The French Revolution happened. Social change came. It was an engineered event. There was no huge protest among French peasants at the time, but the conspirators that had come from Bavaria, Adam Weishaupt, the original Illuminists, you know, they instigated the French Revolution as a way of like engineering a way to be on top of that. You know, if you look at the 1917 revolution in Russia, American bankers funded Lenin going to Russia, you know, the Finland station, all of that. That was paid for by American bankers hoping to get in on the ground floor. They're amoral. But a figure like the American capitalist industrialist Armand Hammer, you know, so what if they're mass murdering communists? Who cares? We're going to be in tight with them right from the ground floor. So you'll often see an evolution in economics that's followed by an evolution in society. When the Industrial Revolution began, it led to factory work. Factory work led to workers living in, you know, mass huddled slums near the factories, which led to unions. Unions then were co-opted by the progressives and communists. But behind them, it's one of the strangest things is to see communists in bed with billionaires, you know, who are like the original Adam Weishaupt. They believe that society is perfectible. In fact, that was one of the other names that Weishaupt was going to give to his Illuminist group, that was going to be the Perfectibility Society. Another one was the Bee Society, like we're all going to be in the beehive, and guess who's going to be the queen bee? So human beings can be figured out and perfected with progressive, super intelligent, super elites. So why shouldn't they also be billionaires? It's kind of perverse and strange, but on the backside of the circle, you know, a lot of times the billionaires actually meet the black bloc. You know, they both profit from revolution and rage and overturning. They all hope to emerge on top of the wreckage after the tsunami.
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. Bracken, in my experience dealing with the black bloc all over the country, I've had them always punch me in the back, act like they did, and trying to make some, you know, big deal happen. They normally get in brand new Mercedes, Jaguars. We have tape of this. These are all pretty much kids, the leaders of it, of rich corporate heads, and their kids are doing military service in America and actually know that they're taking over, and they'll admit to me, we're going to kill you soon. Of course, we're fascist. So they're even more evil than that. I mentioned some of these articles in the last hour. I want to just show TV viewers some of them now and then also read out the headlines for radio listeners so you can see this is happening. Puerto Ricans leaving island for U.S. in record numbers, CNN, due to the economic crisis there and the ongoing default. They're in a full-bore depression. That's in Bloomberg as well. Obama budget $17,613 for every new illegal minor, more than Social Security retirees get. And they won't let Christian refugees come here. For every like 300, 400, there's one token. When 20% of Syria is Christian, and run them for their lives. Hundreds of thousands killed. Why would our elite do that? Ted Cruz's support softens among the delegates he counted. That shows folks are waking up on that front. Lindsey Graham, the queen of the Senate, says Trump would lead to another 9/11. These are the people bringing in the jihadis, funding ISIS and al-Qaeda with Saudi Arabia, caught red-handed. Trump's exposing it, exposing the 28 pages. There's a sick globalist alliance with radical Islam. And they say Trump is going to cause it. It's crazy how they invert reality. Since I mentioned this, NATO deploys 4,000 troops to Russian border as the EU comm chief urges, quote, return to war planning. Meanwhile, watch Germans shut down leftist minister's pro-migrant speech and chase him through the streets. But don't worry. The London Express reports EU military police carrying out extremely worrying civil unrest crisis training. And it's not for the Muslims, folks. They can do whatever they want to encourage the aggression until it explodes. So the elites are doing this on purpose. And I can look at history and things. They're insane. I've run into so many really rich people, I mean billionaires, that are either scared moving to New Zealand years ago, but they tell me, oh, the rest of the elite are nuts. You're right. They're crazy. They want total control. And they like to see us squirm. It's like entertainment. You got 15 mistresses and all the, you know, these elites with Bill Clinton flying to sex islands with little kids, and it comes out, nobody gets in trouble. I mean, when you're into screwing little kids, folks, you're into blowing stuff up and killing innocent people. I'm sorry to talk like that, but that's who we're dealing with here. So I mentioned all that, so I thought I would just, and of course, George Will, in his last article in the Washington Post, saying, we are sovereign, your vote doesn't count. You are nobody. That's what he says. Here, let me say it in White Shoeboy talk, what he actually said. A convention sovereign duty, that's their sovereignty, a convention, that's the party. I'm deciphering. This little arrogant piece of filth thinks we don't understand this. It just meant to sound fancy to you, so you just shut up and go along with it, like the queen with a stupid hat on. A convention sovereign duty is to choose a plausible nominee who has a reasonable chance to win, not to passively affirm the will of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protected process. It's like you come up, mug somebody, and knock their teeth out. And you go, and then I went to your mandibles and massaged them for the lovingness that you would not ever have to deal with them and brush them. I took them from your mouth in a loving flurry. No, you knock your teeth out with a frickin' ball-peen hammer, you little bastard. And it's this type of garbage that I'm sick of. I'm going to stop right there. We're going to start taking your calls in the next segment. 800-259-9231 for Mr. Bracken, a great writer, great brain, really impressed with his work. Want to have him on routinely, want to have him on the nightly news, you name it, even to pop in when events are happening. 800-259-9231 is the toll-free number to join us with your questions or comments on these subjects or for Mr. Bracken or myself. And then just briefly, just as a backdrop to all this, we're running a special on the best horrible food out there at InfoWarsStore.com, powered by my Patriot, the widest selection, 30 to 40% off. I twisted their arms. I'm able to extend it a day, maybe two. It's got to stop, okay, because nobody else has these prices. 10% off all other preparedness items from car jumping, little micro batteries. This stuff gets more and more miniaturized, works so well. It plugs into dozens of different devices. Everything from G-Shock washers, a whole spectrum of the best gravity-fed and survival filters out there. High-quality non-GMO heirloom seeds, the widest spectrum of those out there. High-quality shortwave radios, crank-powered, solar-powered, you name it, and so much more. When you're moving around with cell phones, you need to put them in the little packages with the lead walls so that, you know, obviously you can't be tracked. Just as a rule, folks, for your privacy, those are there. Plus, folks can't hack your phone with those. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Enemies, foreign, and domestic.com. Before you leave today, I want to talk about some of your books, because I can't wait to read those with the different scenarios you come up with for folks to, you know, get inside the game. But we got about 6-7 minutes to break. What other key points do you want to add? Where do you think this is all going? What do you think about Trump? What are other big observations you want to get out to people?
Well, I think that every time that I see or hear, it's a battle for our minds. It really is. It's all about getting the herd running. Now, the herd can be run like buffaloes right towards a cliff. The people that are doing the buffalo herding, they don't plan on going over the cliff edge. They just want to get the buffaloes moving. Whether it's the people that hate Trump so much or the people that love Trump so much, we're gearing up for a big collision. The people that are engineering the collision do not plan to be at the site of the train wreck. They're going to be on a jet to New Zealand or, you know, Chile. Somewhere nice in another hemisphere. I had a lot of great reaction after the show last week, and one person on Facebook said, "Oh, you went on the Alex Jones show. You've lost your credibility." And I said, "What? Do you think they would have me on Fox News? I'm not a script reader. To get on network television, you have to join the club. You have to go to your own little Bilderberg meeting, so to speak. You have to get invited to network, go upstairs and meet the big shots in the top corner office, and that's where they learn that you really are a docile puppy that will roll over and, you know, expose your throat and ask for a rub on the stomach. That you'll never rock the boat. You won't be a loose cannon. You'll stay on script. You'll respect the third rails, and you'll, you know, promote the going narrative. It's basically not that much different from Pravda and Izvestia, except we have more flavors of propaganda. But none of them really go way off of message. Now, I'm old enough to remember Watergate. I was working outdoors construction. The whole summer, they preempted every network channel. You couldn't turn your TV on and not see gavel-to-gavel coverage. The front page of every newspaper for a year was Watergate until Nixon was thrown out. Nobody died in the Watergate. 300 to 400 or more by now, Mexicans died on purpose as a result of Fast and Furious. Benghazi is another case. Americans died. The president was hiding. No help was sent. It's not my point to bring up these old cases, just to study how the media portrays them. If the media had focused on Fast and Furious, hundreds of Mexicans killed so that they could discredit the Second Amendment. During the time before Agent Terry was killed, Holder, Hillary Clinton at State Department, and Obama were on a narrative that I call the 90% lie. Every time they were on a Sunday morning show, they would talk about how it's so terrible that 90% of the guns found in Mexico came from American gun stores.
They were guilting us.
And it's the fault of the Second Amendment, and it's the fault of these gun stores. These were gun stores that were forced and coerced by the ATF. And the but I don't even care about that. I mean, that's terrible. What I care about is that the media stayed away from it. How many Americans know that zero people died at Watergate, hundreds died at Fast and Furious, four died in Benghazi, including an ambassador, which
that's
is
right.
the equivalent
and Cheryl
of a four-star
Atkinson
general.
Basically lost her job at CBS for being the only person in a command position to be able to sneak through the truth. And
Cheryl
let me just stop
Atkinson.
You there. Since you bring this up, Matt, they use all this peer pressure like, ooh, you're discredited, you're on Alex Jones, or, oh, Matt's discredited, Matt Drudge, I think it's more and more popular, he links to Alex Jones. They hate this show because they know how accurate it is. It's reaching 28 million people a week now worldwide, 15 million of them here in the U.S., but we're really a global audience. Like all these corporate guys go, too bad, more than half your audience is overseas, doesn't really matter for money making. I don't care about that at the end of the day. Globally, I want to affect a change. That's the real value. But absolutely, it's a psyop. Like, you can't be for Trump. He's a racist. You're discredited now. People know the media is lying. How bad is it that the mainstream media in an AP poll, also Gallup showed the same number, 6% trust rate? Don't they get they're pathetic and saying we're kooks is our red badge of honor?
When on network television, they've got fantastic production values, great studios, beautiful blonde news readers, every graphic you can possibly imagine, reporters all over the place, but they don't tell the truth. The reason that 28 million people a week are watching Alex Jones is because you go places that they won't go. We look at them now and we just see Pravda. Now you've got, you know, red Republican Pravda, and you got blue Democrat Pravda. But when you've got George Will basically, you know, agreeing with the Democrats that we've got to keep this Trump out, even if we lose even if Hillary wins, George Will's happier with Hillary. But I don't even see that as the problem now, because whether it's Hillary or Trump, by January, this country is going to be in a whole new ballgame. I'll be surprised if nobody takes a shot at Trump. The other day when he hopped the Jersey barricades to get into the rally that was up in Northern California, it reminded me of 1914 in Yugoslavia with the Archduke. Yeah, the bomb, it was a failure. They tried to toss a bomb in his car, and it bounced off and hit went under the car behind. Then their security detail made a series of mistakes, but the conspirators thought the plot had failed. Gavilo Princip was sitting in a cafe, you know, drowning his sorrows at missing his big chance. The security details had kind of a snafu, and here comes the Archduke straight down the street where Gavilo Princip, the mission has already failed, it's an abort, he's having a beer, he steps out and shoots him.
And that was British intelligence manipulating the Black Hand to fool the Germanic group into going into World War I. Absolute total setup. Yeah, folks, the West was pretty much the bad guys in World War I. Then you see what it created. The next group of bad guys, Adolf Hitler in World War II, who was also financed by the British and U.S. elite. They're very sophisticated, but their BS is coming to an end. Look, I know most of you know what we are talking about is true. You've got more experiences than we do. There's a lot of amazing people out there, but the general public still doesn't get how history works. There are groups of ruling predators who don't like freedom and don't like real prosperity. They want total control. Humans are the same all over the world. We go through the same patterns as our guest was just saying earlier. It's totally true. But we've now reached a crossroads with the weapons and the technology and the huge population and all the rest of it, where you have an elite that has passed on its class envy. You're like, well, wait, the elite has class envy? Yes, against the middle class. So they're playing the giant unwashed masses off against the middle class, pressure from below with the elites above. That's their admitted plan. Zbigniew Brzezinski's written books admitting it. He's one of their top gophers, one of their top planners, one of their top generals. And so they've got all these different disparate groups filled with class envy, chips on the shoulders, you name it. None worse than the white knight social justice warriors who just want to see Rome burn, even though these fat, soft, stupid people don't even know how to throw a punch, folks. And I watch them just beat up the Trump people. They just stand there and let them beat them up. I mean, I don't know who is wimpier. But all I know is that is scary looking to me. I don't know what they've done. Is it TV? Is it the culture? Is it modern industrial sickness, like space sickness? I don't know. We're going to go to callers at the start of the next segment. Phones are loaded. Crystal, Shane, Billy, Andrew, Joseph, and others. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. Other points, Matt Bragging, because I know you got cut off with a break, of enemiesforeignanddomestic.com that you want to make. And then also, any rays of hope you see out there?
Well, if anybody goes to my Amazon reviews, you know, one of the most common things is that I saw this coming a long time ago. First book is about a false flag operation blaming, you know, right-wing militias for a massacre. Second book is about the Southwest splitting apart, the country basically fracturing. The third book, the country's completely fractured. Foreign peacekeepers are brought in because American National Guard won't fire on Americans sufficiently well. But you kind of get the idea of what I think could be ahead is not a very rosy scenario. I wish I could be just writing genre fiction, you know, the spies or adventure type of novels. But time is short, and we have to stay on the actual message because the water is going out, and we have to be that kid that's warning everybody that the tsunami is coming. And we can't reach everybody, but we can reach a lot of people. A hopeful sign I've seen in the last couple of weeks, a little bit of is emerging above the surface, this fight between two Navy SEAL admirals. They're talking right now about a fairly parochial issue, but there's a lot of hate and discontent and tension among the flag ranks. And I'm waiting for somebody, an honorable general or admiral, to be as honorable as Colonel David Hackworth was. He was a battlefield commission in Korea as a kid. You know, he did not go to West Point. He was one of the, I think, the youngest colonel in Army history in Vietnam. He wrote the book about face. He went on national news shows and said, the way we're fighting the war can't be won. We're being lied to. He took his uniform off and threw away his career out of a sense of honor, duty, honor, country, you know, integrity, the core values. And I'm not seeing that from our current generals. There are generals, and we can go by their assigned duty stations. We know who was on duty during Benghazi. We know. We know who was in Stuttgart. We know who saw all the flash traffic. If you've seen the movie 13 Hours, they allude to it. There are commandos on runways ready to go and save the little, besieged Alamo in Benghazi. Until then, we have always gone to save the Alamos. In this case, we didn't, because the president wanted the... a few weeks from the election, he didn't want a possible Black Hawk Down scenario.
He also wanted weapons transferred. He wanted weapons transferred into
just
into
hide it. Just Syria. Let that thing be overrun. Just let it be overrun. The terrible breach of faith. And there are generals and there are admirals that know that we're undergoing a cultural Marxist destabilization. You know, transgender military. Hello, can you say good order and discipline? If you were trying to destroy a military, make it combat ineffective, ruin its morale, drive out the best soldiers and sailors, this is what you would do. So why aren't, I look at some of the famous generals that are always on TV on the Sunday morning shows, you know, even Petraeus, come on, salvage your honor, general. Write the memoir now while it makes a difference. Don't punk out and write your memoir.
I agree. Stay there. But it's even beyond honor. You would do it for honor, my friend, Mr. Bracken. These guys need to understand it's end of the line. You're going to get screwed over. All these globos are screwing each other. See, they claim they're going to honor each other, but there's no honor among thieves. That's why it's so dangerous. And they're starting to figure that out, which makes them steal even faster, which accelerates the collapse that much quicker. Whoa. Stay with us. You know, I don't believe this conspiracy is a Nazi conspiracy. But the Nazis were carrying out the latest civilization control technologies the world had. They envisioned the 10-member EU that would then expand into other countries. They wrote and talked about how they would put chemicals and things in food to slowly dumb down and poison populations before finally wiping them out, soft kill. They adopted from the Soviets when they had a deal with them splitting Poland. They let them in and taught them how they put in up to 10 parts or higher per million of hydrofluorosilicic acid in the water. That's in like Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, folks. That was in the Nuremberg trials. They would put acid-based fluoride, weaponized fluoride, in the water to make people docile and also lower fertility. And then we adopted that. Our 68 Gun Control Act is taken except for five or six words, whole cloth, by Senator Dodd, the late Senator Dodd, who was on the Nuremberg trial and changed her 68 Gun Control Act. So I guess the Hugo Boss black uniforms or something. Our elites thought that was really sexy, and they got 34 to 36,000, the numbers vary, in the rat line of Nazis over here to run basically everything, the intelligence agencies. Plus, they were in very short leashes and lived on military bases. Klaus Barbie, you'll run South America with the CIA, and you know this guy, you'll run NASA, and you'll. This is what they did. And my grandfather had been in World War II as a fighter pilot, and he would be as a lease hound out at oil fields and things, work for an oil company, and he'd have to go to a military base to get a chicken fried steak, and it would be like guys in there shooting their mouths off, oh, we really kicked your ass in World War II, we'll kick your ass now. There'd be fights and stuff because that's how arrogant these people were. But see, it's our elites, ladies and gentlemen. It's our elites that are the ones that are so sick-minded they're doing this, the Tuskegee experiment, all the rest of it. But think about it. I mean, I remember being a kid hearing my grandfather talk about all the damn Nazis, you know, at military bases after World War II and how much he hated them. And my mom would just go, he's a little eccentric, but, you know, it was all true. So that's what I'm getting at here is George Soros is a weird freakazoid Nazi collaborator that helped round up thousands of people. He goes on 60 Minutes and says he's not ashamed of it, and the ADL gives him an award. But these people, it's all about perversion. Like, to give a Jewish Nazi collaborator an award for being a Nazi war criminal, they think is really cute. Then they call Donald Trump a Nazi. The ADL came out this weekend and said, yeah, you're like a Nazi saying America first. Nationalism is Nazi. See, I mean, at a certain point, you're like, shut up. Don't try to import Nazism onto me when you're into it up your eyeballs. Anyways, I'm ranting. I want to go to these phone calls. Please sign up for our free newsletter, exclusive articles, exclusive videos, things like that, because it's so easy for them to censor our platforms now. And a lot of times I'm sending exclusive videos and articles out just to the folks on email. It's one of the few areas we're deficient that we never really promoted or pushed. And now with all the censorship coming in, all the experts say go low, high tech. This is the equivalent of, you know, shortwave radio of the future. So Infowars.com/newsletter. I want to go to calls here. Matt Bracken, a lot of amazing points. Enemiesforeigndomestic.com. How do people get in contact with you? Tell us about some of your books. I mean, let's do a plug for all things enemiesforeignanddomestic.com.
Yeah, my first three books are part of a trilogy. They take place in different places. Only a few characters hold over from one to the other, but they sort of follow an evolutionary narrative. The second one is the one that's taking place in the Southwest. It looks like it's a lot of it's coming true today with the big street riots where people are waving Mexican flags. I've always tried, I guess my novels are really to encourage people to look behind the curtain for the masters of the super elites. I'm not saying that they run everything, but boy, they sure do run a lot, including media. And when you can't trust the media, I mean, you know, we're basically being brainwashed and most people are completely unaware of it. So it's up to those of us that see around the brainwashing, you know, to try to reach those of us, our friends and family that are reachable, and let them know that this is a very serious time right now, extremely serious. The waves are already heading for the beach from several directions. All this political squabbling, you know, it might seem quaint. In a year or two, people might be saying, you know, can you believe we were worried about whether Hillary or Trump would be elected? You know, as they're gathered around a barrel with trash in it, you know, for a fire. I mean, you know, the elites that are engineering this burning down the house scenario, you know, they think that on the other end, no matter what, they're going to come back and be in charge again. And maybe they will, because they'll preserve their wealth through the disaster, through the emergencies. The first Baron Rothschild, he changed his name to that, by the way. It means Red Shield. The first Baron Rothschild, who wasn't really a baron either, he said the time to buy is when the blood is running in the streets. He made a killing on Waterloo because his messengers got to England first with news of the battle results. You know, these guys use war as a tool, and they plan to outlast everything. But this super cycle might be bigger than even, say, 1914 to 1918. This might be bigger than World War II. We might look in history a century from now and see that World War I and World War II were sort of like precursor shocks to the big earthquake, which is coming now. Because nothing is going to be a bigger societal earthquake than a grid down.
Sure. Just briefly, though, you made an astute point about New Zealand, but also Chile. I know a lot of really, really rich people that are going into these mountainous, very beautiful redoubts where they're building their own little mini cities with their own little towns with their own imported security forces for what's coming. I mean, I've gone to, you know, elite events where I've been a speaker and things where, you know, there's billionaires, quite a few of them in attendance, and they're going, you need to come with your family to Chile. And they're bugging out down there. They're bugging out to New Zealand. And it is just over the top that I've never seen such a migration out of Israel, out of the U.S. These elites are leaving, and they're going to, like you said, Chile and places Australia and other areas, but especially New Zealand. So that shows to me they really think there's a big probability something huge is coming.
Yeah, I see them going for, you know, the safe places that they think that, and if they have a number of castles, you know, if they have a number, and I just, and not that these are survivalist retreats, but Clooney owns a giant mansion in Los Angeles. He owns a giant mansion in Italy on the water, and he owns a giant mansion in England. So, you know, he can move, and he probably owns some things that he doesn't publicly show. And he's just an example. He's only a 200 millionaire. So imagine what the billionaires have for their preparations. But, and this is more or less directed to young people younger than me. I wrote something called Get Yourself a 30-Footer and Go. It refers to small, cheap sailboats that you can buy for almost nothing in rehab. You know, if you're a young guy or gal and you're fairly physically fit and you don't get seasick and you wish that you had a bug out, that, you know, you wish you had a way to get to New Zealand, read my short essay called Get Yourself a 30-Footer and Go, because there are some ways out. Everybody doesn't have to either be stuck in a city.
I was about to say, though, if you're in a big mega city, it's important to live right by the water. And like you said, have an escape boat or a sailboat, or a sailboat that's got a motor, but also the sails.
Well, right. When I say sailboat, I'm assuming that it has an inboard diesel that can go for hundreds of miles alone, you know, even with no wind, enough to get you way out of the reach of the cities. But there are ways to prepare. And I think that we have to kind of just give up on the general media. You know, we still follow what they're saying on the networks as if, you know, what they're saying is newsworthy. And I think we have to abandon that. I get my own information from websites like yours, Western Rifle Shooters, Gates of Vienna, Vlad Tepes. There are fearless people out there working for nothing. They're not even inside of like a Breitbart type of a company with a salary. They're just doing it out of patriotism. And the information is out there, and the ability to link is super important. I admire Breitbart because they allow links in their comment sections. This might not seem like a significant thing in America, but if you're in Europe where you can be arrested for posting something on Facebook that, hey, I don't like these, you know, all these Muslims pushing our women around, you can be, you know, called in for a talking to in Europe. So being able to spread links is how, that's sort of the modern version of Russian or Soviet samizdat, or the pamphlets of the...
Sure. Well, Zuckerberg, as you know, he's been meeting with the communist Chinese censorship bosses, and they've announced at the Silicon Valley meetings they want to get rid of comments altogether because it's just showing no one agrees, and they've already gotten rid of the links. So, yes, these are serious issues we're talking about. I want to have you back in a few weeks again to talk about what the breakdown in cities will probably look like. I know they've done military studies around the world, but within 9-10 days, most people will start murdering for food. Within about 15 to 16 days, 90%+ will start becoming cannibals. I mean, we're talking about a Viggo Mortensen road scenario within a month.
Yes.
And people just don't understand that.
A true bottleneck event. I wrote something that was maybe one of my most... It's funny because I'm not like in any of the legit, you know, name brand websites where they have to make sure that you're going to stay on message and not be a loose cannon, not rock the boat. I like rocking the boat, and I like, you know, I've always been a loose cannon. So I find a good home at some places that just take what I write. But if you, and I don't care where they are relinked. I say relink everything. Post stuff in whole. I don't care. I did put my first, I put a couple of my books on free on Amazon. For some reason, I couldn't do it until starting tomorrow. But a couple of my books will be free on Amazon tomorrow. Just if anybody's that broke, you know, you can download them.
I tell you, it is a freeing feeling, though, to not, I mean, because I always never worship money, but now I don't even care. I just want to get the word out and stop this and, or save as many people as I can and just get my ass ready and get right
with
God.
What's the point? You know, what's the point of we're like running a kayak and windsurfer stand on the beach of Thailand. It's like, look, I can see, you know, getting your money back for the last guy to bring his windsurfer back on time, but it's really time to be thinking about
dying.
Heading for high ground.
It ain't worth dying. especially when you got kids. I'm going to go to some phone calls. We're going to go to we're going to go ahead and talk to Andrew. We're going to talk to Joseph, Billy, Shane, Crystal, everybody right now. Let's go ahead and talk to Andrew in Ohio. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hello, gentlemen. It's great to talk to you today.
Thank you.
Thanks. I just wanted to ask Mr. Brecken about what he thought about the Dreamer riots in California, and I was listening to your guys' analogy about the Wizard of Oz earlier, and it was really funny, and I bet another analogy could be made about these Dreamer riots, basically like the Munchkins being told to turn on Dorothy as she's trying to free the Land of Oz.
Sure, but these guys are ideological. You have to understand, we have gone so far, just to isolate the Southwest, for example. Every university, every college, the last 40 years has had a very strong Mecha outfit. Imagine a group called the White Student Union, and their symbol is a lit dynamite bomb. And the word means fuse, Mecha. I mean, just imagine that. You'd have to be in an alternate reality.
Well, La Raza means the race.
La Raza is the race. Mecha is fuse with a lit dynamite bomb logo. Well, for 40 years, university students have been graduating. They're now U.S. attorneys. They're judges. They're mayors of towns. You are never going to close the border if the mayor of an adjoining town is a traitor who is pipelining drugs and criminals through his
territory. Well, that's it. They're criminalizing all the cultures. Mexico's fallen to criminal culture. We're falling. And it's not the great people coming in that we elevate. It's literal gangsters. I mean, they're always catching, like, the mayor's brother or whatever here, like, you know, running smugglers through his house, and they're, like, torturing him and stuff for more money. But, and it's just total crazy thugs. And oh, man, I tell you, it is so wild.
The people in La Raza and Mecha believe completely in Marxism. They are Marxist. They're pro-Palestinian. They're all the left-wing causes, you know, anti-Islamophobia, quote-unquote. But they are really hating big time on Whitey. Look up the Plan of Aztlan. They actually
well, that's
have
nothing compared to the Plan of San Diego.
I
mean, do you mean the Plan of San Diego?
Exactly, or called the Plan to Aztlan, but Plan of San Diego, exactly. And they have make no bones about it. They're going to wipe out the white guys. You know, it's the brown race. It's the new bronze race, which is ridiculous. I wrote something else called The True History of the Southwest 101. You know, the Spanish came in as conquistadors. They weren't loving on the Indians. They burned them. They dragged them and
terrible.
Them.
But that's what I mean, though, is that it's just all twisted history. It's not even real.
Very twisted.
And then this whole Aztlan plan is like a twisted German, Austrian-Hungarian Empire World War One manipulation. It's like an old battle plan running.
I'm confusing the Plan of San Diego. The plan of Aztlan.
Yes.
That is this is what they still have as the Constitution.
No, I understand the Plan of Aztlan, absolutely. But it all interfaces. Thank you, Andrew. Let's get in one more here. Before we go to break, Billy in Texas. Billy, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask Matt what he thought. I was reading up on the Mecha organization earlier, and I couldn't help but make a connection between what Judicial Watch has been saying and what you guys have been saying about the Muslims coming in, the radical Wahhabists, coming in across the border, and also the radicalization. How prone are these social justice warriors to radical Wahhabism?
You have to understand that it doesn't matter that women are chained up like dogs. It doesn't matter that they make them wear bags over their heads. It doesn't matter if they execute gay people or the communist Chinese kill gays. They don't care because it's anti-American, anti-West, so it must be good. They don't care that weird, twisted, sicko billionaires are running it all and laughing at them. It is the way to sabotage all these immigrants and others to never actually go up in society. It's meant to balkanize.
It's destabilization. It's a destabilization program. It's intentional. It's like putting so many people on the life raft that it has to tip over and send everybody into the water.
That's it.
You know, you're saying, we need to put 10 more refugees in the life raft. You say, it's only at 1 inch above the waterline. No, we have to put 10 more in, or you're a bigot and a racist. The plan is to turn over the life raft and put everybody in the water.
They're gearing up for it. Anything else, Billy?
I just wanted to say I really support you guys. Just got my first InfoWar product. Been supporting my Hillary for Prison t-shirt. And God bless you. Thank you guys for everything you're doing.
All right. God bless you, sir. I appreciate the call, Billy. Let's go ahead and take another call. I'm going to skip this network break because it's so important. Let's go ahead and talk to Joseph in Pennsylvania. Go ahead.
Hello, Alex. Hello, Mr. Bracken.
Welcome.
Alex, you and your guests are unbelievable. From Bracken to Billy Corrigan to Roger Stone to everyone, it's unreal, and I thank you.
Well, we're all discredited. That's why we're exploding and they're dying. We're discredited. Fox News and CNN said I'm discredited. Oh, no.
Learn more in 10 minutes from Matt Bracken than I can learn in 10 years on the television.
Now, it is kind of fun to watch the ladies cross their legs and uncross them. But, yeah, other than that, you know, there's better stuff than that on the Internet. I don't want to go see that stuff. Sorry, go ahead.
Well, I just would like Matt and you to talk about the troops that the UN just put on the Russian border and the other aggressive maneuver that was made to the C-130 by the Russian fighter jet, I believe, 2 days ago or something like that, the barrel roll.
That's happened a bunch. Yeah, what do you make of NATO's moves? And like Fox News, I mean, I'm not saying Russia's perfect, but they've got two or three bases. We've got hundreds. They're moving troops in. They ran the color revolution there 2 years ago in Ukraine, trying to put crazy right-wingers in. They're playing Catholic off against Orthodox, using, again, sociology, classic anthropology tactics, admitting they spent $5 billion to do it. George Soros, again, quarterbacking it as usual.
Sure. Ukraine. Ukraine was a destabilization op. If you want to see what they're planning here, look at other destabilization ops. They're using a playbook. You can see what's going to happen.
Yeah, they did the destabilization all over Africa and the Middle East to put radical jihadists in. I mean, so why do they want this destabilization? They already pretty much run the world. Why are they doing something so dangerous?
Because we're going to hit the wall. Mathematics, you can't escape from mathematics. Over on Zero Hedge, his name's escaping me right now. But, I mean, yeah, you can't fudge mathematics. You can't pretend that 2 + 2 equals infinity. I mean, there's the end of the debt crisis is coming. And rather than be blamed for it, rather than be sitting in New York and be called down to, you know, appear in front of Congress, they're going to burn it down. They're going to blow it up and burn it down. Oh, gee, it was an act of God. But don't worry, I've got tons of gold down in Chile, down in New Zealand. And when it's all over, I'm going to fly back after the blood is a little sticky from running in the streets, Rothschild there. They're going to fly back and pick up some more castles and estates at fire sale prices. Now, if a few countries go completely, you know, haywire, that's all right. There's plenty of other countries and plenty of more castles.
No, that's it. Just like in Goodfellas, when they've maxed out the bar, everything they can, they burn the sucker down. This is almost a scorched earth retreat.
That's what it is. It's a mafia burnout. It's a mafia takedown. They're crashing it. Then they can blame external forces, acts of God. Oh, it was a war. But don't worry, when it's all over, we'll fly back in and pick up the best castles at dirt cheap prices.
You know what? They could have pulled this stuff off before, and they've gotten away with it a little bit. But the fact that this is already, the message has already gone out, the books are written, people are saving these videos. No matter what they do, we're going to reconstitute this country and others, and we're going to go get them. And this time there won't be a George, you know, there'll be arrest some 97-year-old guard because some document said their name was similar and take them to Israel as a Nazi, just as some, and then the ADL gives awards to real Nazis. I mean, if they're not going to get away with it this time, I guarantee you they have gone too far pulling this off, and I guarantee you the elites and their stinking families that are involved in it are going to pay. And I think it's important to let them know. That we're here explaining. You're going to pay. Go ahead, sir.
It is. It's like warning. It's like warning the Nazis. You know, we're in certain circumstances. Even POWs warned their bosses. Look, you can see how the war is going. You can't kill us all. At the end, there's going to be trials. Well, I don't know what the end of this looks like. If it's a true bottleneck event, we could wind up in a new dark age. A plan to ride a tiger is not the same as riding a tiger. A plan to burn down the house and then, you know, buy the ashes for pennies on the dollar, it might not work out that way. We could enter a new dark age. In terms of cycles, you could say the biggest cycle, the one cycle, is mankind going from hunter-gatherer to modern man. First, he had to master mass agriculture. Once he did that, a city became possible. They domesticated first plants, then animals.
It's taken 8,000 years to get to this point, bare minimum, and now It's so unstable. All elites, all statisticians, all main engineers admit it. It's teetering even if we try to keep it together. And the fact that they're trying to use crisis to consolidate is the craziest. Look. It's like the Deepwater Horizon. It's been confirmed. Was ordered to dump seawater in because an executive knew they could save $1 million an hour, basically, with the amount of concrete and mud they were dumping in. And they had multiple crews quit. So they put a crew on that would say, okay, dump water on it. You know, some guy in Houston says so because some guy in London gave him an order. It's like, no, the engineers know. You do not dump seawater in there to pressurize it. I mean, it's delusion.
Just to save a buck. Just to save a buck. But, you know, when this crisis happens, if it becomes irrevocable, I mean, you almost would say a Stalinist North Korea 1984 would be better than a total grid down Mad Max.
I agree.
With every other nuclear plant going Fukushima, going Chernobyl. I mean, if the plants, if the staff at the nuke plants, they have families too. They don't want to, they're not just going to altruistically chain themselves to their position.
And in 3 weeks, they all blow up.
Or whatever it is. I mean, I haven't heard definitively.
I've had the engineers on the pinning. It's 2 to 4 weeks.
It's not sounding good. And there won't even be a response like the Russians. The Soviets were able to, I mean, very heroic Soviets. You can say what you want about the Russians, but they have very brave men and women. They put hundreds and hundreds of firefighters and other great people on the roof of that building, glowing building, to work for 2 or 3 minutes. They're all dead in a year. And it took that just to cap that sucker. If we have runaway nukes, who's going to, in a grid down scenario, there's nobody organizing a rescue of these nuclear plants. They're
That's bleeding. Why I talk about it's so dangerous, the phenomenon where people don't help each other anymore. When someone's run over in the street or a woman's been raped, people think it's so cute to only care about themselves. 7 million people in major university studies starved to death or via malnutrition associated with malnutrition during the Great Depression here, and 90% of us were agrarian, and more than half of those were totally self-sufficient. We are now reverse numbers, 89% urban, 11% rural, 5.5%, half of them are self-sufficient. My God, 5.5% self-sufficient versus 60%, 50%. I mean, we're talking time bomb.
Yeah, I say, how much food do they grow inside of your beltway? Because that's the only food you're going to have maybe for years or at least months. Best case scenario, you might have to figure out, how do I survive for just a few months? You know, when the pilgrims came over, some of their first colonies were lost due to starvation.
Jamestown, all of them, everybody died.
Right. And if you have a giant city, the people aren't going to stay in the city and die. One of the little essays I wrote in a collection called Trapping Feral Pigs and Other Parables of Modern Life, the lemmings don't stay on the island where they overbred because of a great summer, lots of grass seeds. They don't stay on the island. They bust out of there. When grasshoppers, which are the same as a locust, a grasshopper is a locust, but when a grasshopper population gets up so high that they begin touching each other, releases hormones, they turn into these big armored flying war insects called locusts. They do not stay and die. So we're going to see some very radical transformations. When cities are starving, it's going to be very dangerous.
Within months, there's going to be all sorts of, if this happens, warlords will rise up. There'll be 50 armored vehicles coming down your street, heads on pikes. I mean, it's going to be hell on earth.
It will be. And that's why if people are fit and can take the ocean, read my get yourself a 30-footer and go. If you have a little bit more money, get a 40 or a 50-footer. But even if you're a broke teenager, you can rehab a 30-footer that you get for nothing.
Well, it's what everybody wants. It's some type of weird racial consciousness to want collapse and destruction. And there's a lot of little nobodies that want to be rulers. So they've imagined how they're going to put on little black uniforms and be in the new commie brigade. And all you're going to get is your gut stomped out. We'll be back in 60 seconds to finish a few final calls from Crystal and others for our guest, Matt Bracken. I'm Alex Jones. Fourth hour straight ahead. David Knight's coming up. If Europe collapses, it'll just be a total slaughter. Here in the United States, in the West, the South, other heavily armed groups with historical will to fight and highly armed, it is going to be spectacular bloodbath. And I hope we don't go down that road. We're going from that being a possibility to that being a probability. Mexico's got over 100,000 admitted dead, 70-something thousand missing. That's what a partial collapse looks like. And that place is a growing bonanza. and super ingenious, hardworking people, and it's still falling apart. This is what happens to civilizations, and all these trendies just don't understand it. I really feel sorry for them. And what I really get scared of is the elites running for the hills like chickens with their heads cut off. Let's talk to Crystal in North Carolina. Crystal, thanks for calling. Welcome.
Hi, Alex. Hey, Matt. Thank you so much for everything you do. And, Alex, you guys have an awesome soundtrack. I love every song you guys play.
Well, thank you, sweetheart.
I had a quick question, I guess, for both of you guys. You know, as you can see, I'm in North Carolina, and we've been having the whole transgender bathroom issue blowing up all over.
What a diversion.
And that was my question. Is this more just part of the elite divide and conquer? Or
this is level five warfare, ma'am, on the species to create total confusion. It's where you're losing your whole future. We're going to obsess over bathrooms. Matt?
It's part of the destabilization process. The Soviet Union tried for 75 years just to change the part of human nature dealing with economics. You know, you're going to go to the factory and work hard for the state, but you can still marry who you choose and, you know, live a normal life if you don't stay and get into politics. But we're trying to do something. Our social justice warriors are trying to do something far more profound and unbelievable, which is to change our sexual nature, to make people say, oh, if you big 300-pound man, if you feel like you're Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz, then I'm going to call you Dorothy. If I don't call you Dorothy, I'm a bigot and a hater. This is obviously not meant to succeed. It's part of the destabilization process.
And taxpayer-funded pouring bleach in women's eyes that want to be blind, and everyone says how beautiful and brave they are? No, you're freaking nuts.
Sure, it's a mental illness, and to treat it, I mean, if somebody walks around dressed like Napoleon with his hand like this and demands to be called Napoleon, we say, sorry, Napoleon, you have to, you know, we're going to put you in a safe place. But if a guy says, I'm a woman, you know, a male Olympian declares he's a woman, doesn't get an operation, anything like that, we are now supposed to go along with the mass delusion.
You say stunning and brave.
It's mass delusion, and it's very dangerous. It's like everybody's trained to say the emperor's clothes are magnificent, and a few of us go out there and say, no, he's buck naked. So I'm so grateful for your show, because you've got the mass audience without selling out, you know, without getting the ride up the elevator to corporate, you know, where you learn the secret handshake. And I don't play that game, and you don't, and people are catching on. It's very important that this as long as we communicate.
Absolutely, and I'm just one person. There's so many other great people up and coming. What the elites do is, as soon as you start an alternative media operation, they try to sue you, they mess with you, they send in infiltrators once you get bigger, or they try to cause infighting, and most people just get into the infighting and get diverted off mission. Just ignore all the made-up BS, move forward with the issues, so that when an audience tunes in, they hear about things they're concerned about, not, you know, I'm not CIA, or I'm not a Vatican, or I'm not a new, you know, all bull. Just here's the topics, here's the info, what do you think, move forward. And that's just the best advice I can give folks, is just get on mission. It isn't be an attack. Don't get obsessed because the media attacked you. Be proud of people like, I'm so sorry, I saw the newspaper saying you were a horrible person. It's like, that's an enemy publication. My God, I'm so proud of it. And start celebrating that the enemy's attacking. Matt Bracken, God bless you. Enemiesforeignanddomestic.com. We'll talk to you very soon, my friend. Thanks for the time.
Thanks.
Find his books on his website, ladies and gentlemen. Infowars.com is my site. Don't forget, we've got 30 to 40% off on the storable foods and 10% off on all survival goods. Only for just 4 or 5 days on the other stuff, but only a day or two on the food. It's all I can do.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show, our fourth hour on this Monday, May 2nd, 2016. I'm going to go to the callers who are still on the line. Shane, Ben, Carmen, hang on there for just a moment. I'll get to you in just a second. I want to give people an overview of what we're going to be talking about this hour. There's an interesting story that is broken that fits right in with what we're hearing from CIA Director John Brennan about the 28 pages. And this is a story from Cy Hirsch saying that Hillary Clinton approved sending Libya's sarin gas to Syrian rebels. Now, we're going to break that down, the information that he's talking about, the fact that he has now put Hillary Clinton and the rat line where she belongs, folks. And this is key. This is why we've said the 28 pages is so important. You know, we talk to some people and they'll say, well, unless the 28 pages say, I'm sorry, I did it, They're not interested. But this is the way it's going to gradually unravel. And I've said this as we're looking to, as we've talked about the 28 pages in the past. It's going to start unraveling this narrative. It's going to bring in the Saudis. When it brings in the Saudis, it's going to pull in the CIA because they are joined at the hip. And we can see that when we look at these articles. We're also going to be talking about the brokered convention on the Democrat side. We've now got Bernie Sanders saying that he thinks that this should go to a brokered convention. He's behind Hillary, but very slightly, 1,600 to 1,300 in terms of pledged delegates. In other words, those would be delegates that were selected by an election. But when you look at the superdelegates and you throw those in, Hillary Clinton has a tremendous advantage there. She's got 520 to his 39, so she's got a large advantage there. And what he is saying is that he's going to try to appeal to the, I guess, the sense of fairness, shall we say, of the Democrats. Hey, come on, guys, let's be fair. You know, I've got a lot of votes here. I want you guys to come over. I want you to fall in line, essentially fall in line according to how your states voted. So, for example, if he had won New York, he would ask the New York delegates to fall in line, the superdelegates to fall in line with him. Now, of course, prior to the New York election, they said they wouldn't do that, and he didn't win anyway. So I think it's going to be interesting. It will be an interesting argument if Hillary doesn't win it outright with elected delegates, if she has to rely on the superdelegates. It ought to make them upset. And, you know, I look at this. We're going to have a call. Somebody called in yesterday who was a Virginia delegate to the GOP, where they were actually selecting the delegates that had been won in the election by Donald Trump, but then were flipped to go for Ted Cruz. And this lady who called in said she was really upset. She had been a Cruz delegate. She wasn't one of the people who was selected at the Virginia convention. And she said it had really soured her on Ted Cruz and on the process in general. And that's the key thing, folks. As we see people like George Will unmasking and saying, you know, we don't need to be bound by these decisions that were made elsewhere. Where were those decisions made, George? They were made in the ballot boxes across America that you are so contemptuous of. You and your elitist scum at the top, the Republicans and the Democrats. Let's understand what's going on here. But quite frankly, I don't think that Bernie's going to have much of a leg to stand on. I mean, what we're going to be looking at possibly with a Democrat convention is kind of like a fight between Trotsky and Lenin. You know, is Trotsky going to, Trotsky and Stalin, I should say, is Stalin going to run Trotsky out of the Communist Party? But it's still something that everybody should be concerned about. I don't want to see a situation where you got party insiders, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, who are selecting the delegates and pretending that we have an election. And it's a good thing that that mask is being taken off. So before I get to these stories, let me go to the callers who've been hanging on for a while. Let's go to Ben in Missouri. Ben, you got a comment or question?
Hey, David. Good to talk to you.
Good talk to you.
I was hoping to talk to Brack, and I read Tet Take 2 back. It had to be like 3 months ago, and I reposted it on Facebook like 5 times because it just sent chills down my spine. It was right on, and the way that the language that he used was just amazing. Anyway, but I had one of these truth is stranger than fiction moments on today. You know, it's the anniversary of SEAL Team 6, and most listeners know what happened to SEAL Team 6.
Yes.
But back in 2011, in April of 2011, during the White House Correspondents' Dinner, and you can look up this video on YouTube, Obama starts making fun of Donald Trump because of the whole birther conspiracy. He plays the Lion King and says it's the video of his birth in a joking manner. And then, really oddly, says Michelle Bachmann shouldn't run for president because she's from Canada. Anyway, the next day, right, we get the Situation Room video, all that kind of stuff, right? So then the craziest thing is the day before Obama had his press conference, which was during the week's episode of The Apprentice, Donald Trump had responded to what Obama had said at the White House correspondence meeting by saying he was the worst president of all time.
Mm-hmm.
So if you just, I mean, just in the grand scheme of things, it's just amazing the way that things shake out, because now we have Donald Trump 5 years later, you know, fighting for his life to get into the presidency against somebody who was you know, born in Canada. And it just is the crazy world that we live in.
And so, and one of the things that really concerns me is so many of the people that I believe rightfully questioned why there was so much secrecy surrounding Barack Obama's credentials and his birth certificate and things like that. The people who I think were right to question that are now just looking the other way when it comes to Ted Cruz. I'm absolutely amazed and disappointed at so many people in the grassroots. I don't expect anything from the people who are party establishment, who are media establishment. I don't expect them to play fair. They're going to play partisan, okay? But I'm really disappointed in the grassroots who aren't looking at this. Let me ask you before you go, Ben. Did you see the fact that the CIA was tweeting out over the weekend, they were tweeting out yesterday, details of the bin Laden raid on the five-year anniversary? Did you see that?
I did not see it.
Amazing. I mean, this is like something from The Onion or something, because we've had so many people on here. Steve Pachinik and others talking about how phony this is, and we know what happened to SEAL Team 6 in the wake of that. Very suspicious, isn't it, that they all disappeared. When that happened, my son said, we were looking at that, and my son said, well, you're going to see a lot of SEAL Team 6 people disappear, and it wasn't very long, actually, before that happened. He knew that was going to happen. But let me read you some of the comments that people had. Here's one of the one of the tweets on Twitter. Okay, what other world events should the CIA retroactively live tweet? Personally, I want a breakdown of the Castro exploding cigar fiasco. I mean, this is amazing. This is the official government conspiracy theory. And just in case it hasn't been discredited enough, they're going to tweet it out, this fiction that they put out, this fiction that they made a movie of, okay? They worked with their people in the media to make a movie, to make it more real. And now to make it even more real, they're going to tweet out the details of it. They did that yesterday. I think maybe they should also tweet out a real-time timeline of what happened maybe with the Bay of Pigs or the JFK assassination. Maybe we could do that this year for the anniversary of the JFK assassination. What was the CIA doing at that point? Where were George Bush and JFK and Lyndon Johnson, all these people? I think it's absolutely amazing. But that's the kind of work that we're seeing, the kind of fiction that we're seeing from the CIA. Thank you, Ben. Let's go real quickly to Carmen in New Jersey. Carmen, go ahead.
Hey, David.
Hey.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you. Go ahead.
Oh, David, it's so great to talk to you. I just first, before I say anything, want to thank you personally because I entered that Paul Revere contest with my band Imagination, and you actually chose our video and put it on your nightly news show, and I never got to personally thank you for that.
Well, thank you. I thank you for doing it because that was, there was a lot of great work, a lot of great work that was done by people, and I really appreciate you putting that in. That is the key, for people to get out there and understand the power that they have to change people's minds by putting together videos, doing music, doing all these different things that everybody did in that contest. That was a great contest. Thanks for participating in that.
Oh, it was my honor, and I really, you know, it makes me think, you know, back in the days of, you know, Watergate, you know, Crosby, Stills, Nash came out with Ohio and all these songs. Where are all the artists today? Why aren't they using their voice? I understand a lot of them are locked in their contracts, their death, satanic contracts.
Yeah.
But the ones that aren't, really, like, we should have a Woodstock for this free. If things are as dire as, like, everybody's talking about, there needs to be a lot more banding together. And I think also the lack of Jesus Christ, because obviously these people are Luciferians and they're satanic. What is their biggest enemy to them is the name, the words, Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And when Alex goes on these kind of like these preacher modes, he always stops himself. And I'm saying to myself, no, that needs to be done more. As much preparation as we need for, you know, stockpiling food and water, we need spiritual preparation because nobody's preparing for their afterlife.
That's right.
We're saying it in that way.
There's power in that name. You know, it's interesting. One of the stories that I had on here, Carmen, was a story from NPR this weekend. It was yesterday. And it asks, does addiction treatment require a higher power? Now, this was done by a psychiatrist, I believe, based on her take. I didn't look up her credentials here. But basically, they were saying, you know, do you really have to have the kind of, you know, the 12-point steps that we have from Alcoholics Anonymous and other things to get results? They say 80% of current American addiction treatment for both alcohol and other drugs is based on teaching patients the ideology of the steps and persuading them that they need to become members, they need to try to get help with something that is explicitly moral. And I thought, when I looked at this article here, I thought, what if conservative Christians really believed that Jesus had the power to change their lives? Would they really look to government to do everything for them? Would they really look to the war on drugs to change people's lives? You know, that is a very interesting question, and I honestly don't think they do. And I think when I look at the public displays of piety from Ted Cruz and others, when I look at the war on drugs that they support, I don't think they really believe that it has the power to change lives, but it does. I've seen it in my life. I've seen it in other people's lives. Thank you so much, Carmen. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm going to go over some news here in just a moment. Remind you that we've extended the InfoWars Select Storable Food Sale, 30 to 40% off all storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. We have listened to your calls, your emails, your comments. We were able to get this extended by the manufacturer. That's 30 to 40% off the retail price of all InfoWars Select Storable Food. Of course, that's a shelf life of 25 years, all made in the USA, non-GMO, great packaging to help you preserve that food, as well as 10% off all preparedness products and Survival Shield X2 at InfoWarsLife.com. To help you get prepared with your family, we're giving you 10% off all things like shortwave radios, heirloom seeds, water filters, watches, security products, and survival accessories. And you know, just this last weekend, it happened, I guess it was about 4 o'clock in the morning on Saturday. We were woken up by some heavy, heavy winds at my home. Snapped a tree in the backyard, fortunately did not hit the house. We were out of power from 4 a.m. to about 6 p.m. Later on Saturday. And as we're doing that, we realize just how unprepared in many ways we are at our home. It's very easy for us to just go off and go to a restaurant or something because it was very localized. We had 2,000 people who lost their power just southeast of Austin. But that was kind of an interesting situation. It was, unexpected, and we had 75-mile-an-hour winds. I mean, they were just snapping tree trunks, not just breaking off limbs, but the tree that broke in our backyard was a thriving, surviving tree, and it just snapped on the trunk. And we saw that happen all over the area. You never know when disaster is going to happen. You never know how long it's going to take for you to get your power back. When we were back in North Carolina, we were out of power once for days. We had a hurricane come through there. Hurricane Fran came through again, knocking over trees, taking out power lines over such a large area. And we were out in a remote area. They are always going to go to the most number of people first. They're going to triage it that way. So we were in a neighborhood that was very remote. There weren't very many of us on that part of the power grid. So it took them a week for us to get our electricity back. That was a very uncomfortable situation, even though we could go into other areas where we could get power. What are you going to do when it is over a much larger area, when it involves everybody, if that's the case? Okay, you need to prepare for your family. And just as we were talking yesterday, Rob Dew was in here, and he said, some lady saw InfoWars. She goes, "Oh, you're a bunch of preppers, aren't you?" And he said, "Here's a lady who's living on an earthquake fault in San Francisco mocking us because we're preparing." She obviously, and also in a big city as well. All the, tick off all the boxes to put yourself at risk. There, this lady had them all ticked off, and she's laughing at InfoWars because we prep. Yeah, you should think about that. Really should. And so we've extended these sales on select storable food, 30 to 40% off at InfoWarsStore.com and 10% off all preparedness products and Survival Shield X2, that's our nascent iodine, at InfoWarsLife.com. Going back to the articles here that we've got today, this is something that just really made me feel the burn, I should say. Not that I want to vote for Bernie Sanders, a socialist. It made me feel the burn about our socialist government and about Obama's agenda. Listen to this. This is from the Washington Examiner. Obama budgets $17,613 for every new illegal minor, and that is more than Social Security retirees get. It's almost $3,000 more than a Social Security retiree is going to get. Think about that. You pay 15%, actually 15.62%, because your employer is paying part of this and you're paying part of this. You just don't see your employer's contribution, but your employer knows that's the cost of you working for them. So your employer is doing an equal invisible contribution, knows that that's embedded in your cost. That's money that perhaps they could hire more people or they could pay you more if they didn't have to pay that, so that you're bearing the full cost of that. Over 15% of your salary goes in without any deductions, 15% off the top, your entire working life. And how does the federal government repay you? They bring in illegal miners and then give them benefits that are $3,000 a year more. Those kids aren't coming here to make sure that you've got Social Security. The government doesn't care about your Social Security. You need to understand that from the very beginning, the first place they had Social Security was in Germany, wasn't it? And why did Bismarck pick the age of 65? That was the life expectancy of people in Germany. They never planned on putting out very many benefits, and that's why they're talking about raising the age. But here's where it gets even worse. When we look at these dreamer riots, these young kids who come over here and flip us off and demand subsidies. Think about the fact that when you have to pay for them in schools, it's going to cost you your home in taxes eventually, because there's no end in sight to this, folks. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and as we're looking at the games that are being played by both the Democrat establishment and the Republican establishment with superdelegates, with flipping the delegates, you know, the voters choose delegates to go to the convention for Trump. Instead, we're going to find delegates going to the convention for Cruz. And I say, oh, don't worry, we'll vote for Trump in the first round, and then all bets are off. That's not why these people were chosen. They ought to have a situation where the candidate themselves select the delegates after they win them at the election. That would be an honest election. But, of course, they don't want that. They don't want the wrong people voting. So when we look at this, and I look at all these calls that are going everywhere for a constitutional convention, I want to ask you, do you really trust these Republicans that are messing with the convention that's coming up? Do you really trust them? Or the Democrats, for that matter, and their superdelegates for Hillary, do you really trust these people to run a constitutional convention? Because they're going to be the ones who are running the constitutional conventions, you understand? And they're going to be the same ones telling you, if only we could change the Constitution, then we would have law and order. These are the people who take the oath to the Constitution and then ignore it, okay? We've got a Constitution. They're not paying any attention to it. If they wanted to start paying attention to the Constitution, if they would first illustrate to us that they would follow the Constitution we have, then I might be open to listening to them about a Constitution false, okay? Because it's not perfect. There are things that we could change in the Constitution, but I don't trust a bunch of criminals who thumb their nose at the law, just like the illegal aliens thumb their nose at our borders, okay? We've had our politicians thumbing the nose at the borders that we conscribed around them with the Constitution for a long time. You have to understand, at least in my opinion, I think the whole point of these constitutional conventions is to give them plausible deniability, to allow them to escape prosecution one day. If we were to get some people of integrity in Washington, they could go back and they could pass these laws to make what they're doing not a crime. That's what we see happening with CISPA, isn't it? Or now they call it CISA. They tried PIPA, ACTA, SOPA, CISPA two or three times, and they got it through with CISA, which basically took away criminal liability from corporations who were spying on you, took away their civil liability, took away, we could argue, I don't think it really does, but they're going to try to argue that takes away the criminal liability of the government actors who are doing these dragnet surveillances and quote-unquote warrants, okay, where they get a warrant for Mr. and Mrs. Verizon and they listen to everyone's conversations. That's what these pieces of legislation are really about. They're breaking the law. They know they're breaking the law, and they want to come in after the fact and change what they've been doing to not be against the law, hoping they can escape prosecution. Let's look at this article. Going back to April the 19th, Oklahoma House asked the Congress to call a constitutional convention. And there's been a lot of states who have been doing this. We've had Governor Abbott, who I really respect on most issues. I believe he's very wrong in terms of a constitutional convention. I'll tell you why. And this article from New American says, after defeating a resolution last year asking Congress to call a convention of the states, the Oklahoma House of Representatives reversed course this week, passed the measure 5733 with 11 abstentions. Although it passed the Senate last year, Senate Joint Resolution 4 will return to the Senate for consideration of House amendments. Now, here's the interesting part. 15 legislators switched their votes after intense lobbying, including personal visits to most Republican House members by former Senator Tom Coburn, who is a huge supporter of the idea of a constitutional convention. Now, remember, under Article 5 of the U.S. Constitution, amending it, you can do it a couple of different ways, okay? All 27 amendments so far have been done by passing a two-thirds vote of both the Senate and the House by Congress, okay? Both houses of Congress have put in all 27 amendments that we have so far. Proponents of the Convention of the States or the Constitutional Convention method are attempting to make use of a second method, one that we have never used before. Ah, isn't that interesting? All these people who talk about how malleable the rules are when we're coming up to the GOP convention, these are the same people who are going to be making it up as they go along at a constitutional convention. Now, some of them will say, I've got a whole laundry list. Everybody's got a laundry list of things that they want to fix at a constitutional convention. But they tell us, don't worry, we'll make sure that it doesn't get out of control. We'll make sure that it only affects these one or two issues, or it'll only affect my particular issues. How are they going to do that? You trust them to do that? I don't trust these guys to do anything. I would definitely not trust them with the Constitution. Now, they point out in this article, I think this is a very interesting case. They say Oklahoma has been targeted by the Balanced Budget Amendment Task Force, okay? Now, this is what is driving it in a lot of states, and this is one of the things that people like to see. Let's have a balanced budget amendment, okay? Now, whether you're for that or against it, understand that if you've got a single issue like that, and a lot of these people who tell us that a constitutional convention can be confined to a single issue, then fine, tell them. Then take that single issue and try to get it through the Congress, okay? Try to get it through the Congress. Here's what they point out in this article. They say that there are states all over the country that have balanced budget amendments. They say pro-constitutional convention legislators made the case that Oklahoma, like every other state except for Vermont, have a requirement for a balanced budget, but no such requirement exists for the federal government. Fine. They say a balanced budget has been part of Oklahoma's constitution since the early 1940s, but state legislators routinely circumvent the requirement by issuing bonds. Oh, don't they all do that? Not just Oklahoma, but they all issue bonds. They issue bonds to build roads, to make capital repairs, so forth. They protest that there's a revenue stream that will pay off these bonds, so it's not really debt. Okay. Think about that. Every state I've lived in, we've had massive bond issues. They say, we've got balanced budgets, but we also have these bonds where we are borrowing money. Okay, it's only different in terms of the magnitude of money that's being borrowed. It's not fundamentally different in principle than the money that we're borrowing from the private Federal Reserve. And so the point that they're making in this article, I think it's a very good point, and they sum it up by saying, it's like saying if a person has a job and they're making house payments each month, they're not really in debt, okay? And only politicians think like that, and the people that they fool. See, the problem is not the Constitution. The problem is the criminals and the District of Criminals in Washington, D.C. That's the real problem. And I do not trust the District of Criminals or the people who are going to be running this. The people who are going to be running these conventions, folks, are the superdelegates. They are the people who say that they're going to determine who the nominee is going to be on the GOP side, on the Democrat side, and they could care less about you. And you know what? They could care less about the Constitution. As we pointed out many times, just take a look at the war on drugs and look at what happened. We've got 27 amendments. Two of those are about alcohol prohibition. They needed an amendment to have alcohol prohibition, and then they had another amendment to undo that. Why did they need an amendment for alcohol prohibition? Because the federal government has no authority in the Constitution to prohibit anything. Anything. They have no authority to prohibit prescription drugs, for example. That could be done at the state level. You could have drug prohibition done at the state level. And as a matter of fact, after alcohol prohibition was finished, we had all kinds of state prohibitions about alcohol. You had to buy it in some states at an ABC store that was run by the state. Maybe you couldn't buy it on Sundays or whatever. So the states have put in their own legislation there. But the Constitution, the Ninth and Tenth Amendment, said that the federal government didn't have that. So they created an amendment to allow them to prohibit alcohol. Where are the amendments to prohibit marijuana or cocaine or heroin or anything that we take that's a prescription drug? Where are those amendments? They don't even bother to pretend to follow the Constitution. So why would we give them a constitutional convention? It's simply so they can cover their tracks and protect themselves, folks. You need to understand the scam. You need to understand who's going to be running that thing. Now, there was a major article that came out today, I think. Cy Hirsch is talking about how Hillary approved sending Libya's sarin gas to Syrian rebels. Think about that. Remember back in 2012? And we were sounding the alarm. I remember Paul Joseph Watson doing articles. We were talking about it. We said, they are setting this up. This is a false flag. They're saying that the sarin gas came from Assad. Assad is not a good guy, but they're using this as an excuse to drag us into a ground war. And eventually it started to come out. The information started trickling out. First, you had some people who were on the side of Assad making the case, look, this is not his stuff. And then you had others making that case. And eventually you had people inside the U.S. government making that case. And we stood them down. We had people saying, we're not going to go to war for a false flag attack. This is what Cy Hirsch says about this. Remember, Cy Hirsch is a Pulitzer Prize winning. He's formerly worked for the New York Times. And he doesn't have any problems blowing the whistle on these people. He pointed out, to a report from British intelligence saying that the sarin gas that was used did not come from Assad's stockpiles. And of course, we had that from British intelligence. We eventually had it from U.S. intelligence. First, we got it from Russian intelligence. We got it from many different sources. Hirsch also said a secret agreement in 2012 was reached between the Obama administration and the leaders of, listen, folks, the usual suspects, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, to set up a sarin gas attack and blame it on Assad so the U.S. could invade and overthrow Assad. This is what he said, quote, by the terms of the agreement, funding came from Turkey as well as Saudi Arabia and Qatar. The CIA, with the support of MI6, was responsible for getting arms from Gaddafi's arsenals into Syria. Now, he didn't say whether these arms included the precursor chemicals for making sarin gas stockpiled in Libya, but he said there have been multiple independent reports that Gaddafi possessed such stockpiles. Also, the U.S. consulate in Benghazi, Libya, was operating a rat line for Gaddafi's captured weapons into Syria through Turkey. Now, this is an article I should have said from Zero Hedge that I'm reading from. Listen to this quote. Evidence leads directly to the White House, to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Martin Dempsey, to CIA Director John Brennan, to Saudi Intelligence Chief Prince Bandar, and Saudi Arabia's Interior Ministry. What have I said about these 28 pages, right? We've said this. I said it. I think it's last time I said it was nightly news a week ago, that the 28 pages, once they start to come out, is going to unravel the official conspiracy theory. And it's going to show connections between Saudi Arabia and Prince Bandar and the CIA. And who are the people that are involved in this false flag attack in 2012? The usual suspects, isn't it? And lo and behold, here we have CIA Director John Brennan saying yesterday that releasing the 28 classified pages from the 9/11 Commission report would be a mistake because they contain inaccurate, unvetted information that could be used to tie Saudi Arabia to the terrorist attacks. Yeah. He's throwing the FBI investigators under the bus, telling us that basically they're a bunch of lunatic conspiracy theorists, and that there's no substantiation of this. And he says that they're unvetted. Well, what was the 9/11 Commission about? What was the rest of their official story about? I guess, can we trust the rest of the official story from the 9/11 Commission? You know, that fairy tale about three buildings collapsing right into their footprint when only two of them were hit by planes. Two planes, three buildings. Two planes, three buildings. And we played a really catchy tune that was done by, I forget the guy's name, sorry. We've interviewed him. He did a great piece with that Two Planes, Three Buildings, just hammering that into people. You need to think about that. It's not just Building 7. It's three buildings fell down after two planes. The common core math of the 9/11 official conspiracy theory. Now, they don't want you to see this. They don't want you to see the connections to Saudi Arabia, because then you will see the connections, as Cy Hirsch is pointing out, of how Prince Bandar and the Saudi intelligence system is tied to the CIA, especially people like John Brennan, who is pouring water on the idea that the 28 pages should be out there. And as I pointed out last Monday night on the nightly news, Bob Graham, who has been pushing for this from the very beginning, saying, let's put out this information about the Saudis, let's put this out. He was called in and intimidated by the number two person at the FBI a couple of years ago. He had been calling on them and saying, what can I do to get you guys to help me to put out this information that you gave us? It's been classified. He and others have said it should not be classified. So you've got Bob Graham, who was chair of the Senate Select Intelligence Committee. You've got John Kerry, who, Democrat, who was on there. You've got Lehman, who was Reagan's Secretary of the Navy. All these guys. So there's absolutely no reason for this to be classified, except to protect John Brennan, Prince Bandar, and the Saudis. Now, this is what Brennan says. He says, I think the 9/11 Commission took that joint inquiry in those 28 pages or so and followed through on the investigation, then came out with a very clear judgment. There was no evidence, but the Saudi government or Saudi officials provided support. That's not what the members are saying. That's not what they're alluding to. As a matter of fact, to try to get Bob Graham to shut up, to try to intimidate him, that's why he was on a Christmas holiday. He says, I was very surprised that they knew that I was going to be in town that day. He goes, I guess he's a little bit naive about the surveillance state, because this is a guy that left Congress in the early 2000s. Maybe he wasn't paying that close of attention. I don't know. But he says he was very surprised and kind of taken back that they would take an interest in him. See, the security state takes an interest in everybody, especially the senators and the congressmen. And these guys who have supported the Patriot Act will find out that they're going to be the first ones arrested by the intelligence state when it gets to a certain level. They're going to take out the politicians first. They think, these people at the top always think that they're playing along with the system, and they don't realize that their necks are going to be the first ones on the chopping block when the revolution comes, and not by the people, but by these Homeland Security goons that they have created. The same ones who ushered him into, basically, as in, come with me, took him, put his wife into a holding cell where she couldn't talk to anybody. They didn't have anything for her to read. She was there for quite some time. They gave her some FBI manuals. Perhaps it was the only time those FBI manuals were read. I don't know. Certainly, they didn't have a copy of the Constitution, but they kept him there and told him that they didn't want him to keep talking about this. But he has continued. He's persisted on this. And he's talked about this for a number of years, and sometimes it gets to a critical mass because of one person, what they say. You know, we saw that with NSA whistleblowers for a very long time. We had William Binney, we had Thomas Drake and others who went to the mat to try to tell us what was going on at the NSA, but they couldn't get traction until Ed Snowden came along. We had others with the 9/11 report trying to point out how phony this is, how fishy this is. They can't get traction until Donald Trump says release the 28 pages. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In this last segment we've got here, I want to play for you a call that we had yesterday that I think was very interesting about what's going on with the delegates. Before we do, I just want to remind you that we have a new special, 10% off all preparedness products and Survival Shield X2 at InfoWarsLife.com. That's all shortwave radios, heirloom seeds, water filters, watches, security products, survival accessories. Take a look at what we have there. This is a key time to prepare for the future. And along with that, we have extended the InfoWars Select Storable Food Sale of 30 to 40% off. That's at InfoWarsStore.com. That unprecedented sale of preparedness products, 10% off. off all of our preparedness products, as well as 30 to 40% off all select storable food. Now, that has a shelf life of 25 years, made in the USA, non-GMO, the best packaging you're going to find on storable food. That, along with all the other preparedness products. Take a look at what we've got at InfoWarsLife.com. Prepare for your family, for yourself. Now, as we were talking yesterday, that it was absolutely amazing. The end of the week, they had the actual selection of the people who were going to be delegates. We had the voters come in and select the delegates in Arizona. 47%, Trump won 47% of the vote. He got all 58 delegates. And yet, when they select the actual people to go, former Governor Jan Brewer, who she tweeted out, I've been elected to five straight national conventions, but they mysteriously took her name off the ballot. So the former governor's name was taken off the ballot. Why? Because she supported Donald Trump. And that's the crooked way that they're running this game now. We had a caller who called us yesterday. I want to play a little bit of that clip for you. She was a delegate to Virginia, where Donald Trump won most of the delegates. And she was a Cruz supporter before she went to the convention. Listen to what she had to say yesterday. To Terry in Virginia. Terry, we've got just a little bit of time, and if we don't have time, we'll hold you over through the break. Go ahead, Terry.
Hi. I just wanted to report two things. I was a delegate at the Virginia State Republican Convention over the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that was a troubling thing is that we came away voting on a slate that had 10 Cruz delegates.
Okay, hang on. We're going to go to a break. We're out of time. You can tell us what the results were when we come back. Stay with us. David Knight, Rob Dew, and Josh Owens, and our caller there, Terry in Virginia. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight with Rob Dew and Josh Owens. We've been talking about what happened in California with the Dreamer riots, and now we're going to take your calls. We were just talking to Terry in Virginia. She was a delegate to the Virginia GOP convention. Terry, we ran out of time just as you were telling us what happened there. Recap how many people were there and what the decision was that was made. Go ahead.
Well, there were supposed to be over 5,000 delegates were supposed to attend, but we ended up with less than 3,000 that showed up. We were given a list of 78 delegates to go to the national convention. 27 of those delegates had committed to Cruz, 16 committed to Trump. We had 32 that were undeclared and 3 for Kasich. And at the end of the day when we were ready to vote, they handed us what they call a slate. And this is, I'm not exactly sure how they choose these 13 delegates to go to the national convention out of the 78 that we were given, but we ended up with 10 Cruz delegates going to the national convention and 3 Trump in a state where Donald Trump won 35% of the popular vote and Ted Cruz won 17%. Now, I was a voter in favor of Ted Cruz, so I'm not like he wanted to stay on Hannity, that I'm not a Trump whiner that's complaining about this delegate process. But it was obvious to me at the end of the day that this was rigged. It was stacked.
All right, you can hear the rest of that at the Alex Jones Channel. Join us tonight for the nightly news at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.